catch. The Kayaton touchdown.
He into the ring.
You're looking live at Scott Stadium on the campus of the University of Virginia for today's 2023 VHSL Class 5 Football State Championship, featuring the Stonebridge Bulldogs at 9-4 and the Maury Commodores at 14-0. Hello, everyone, and welcome to our exclusive coverage here online at NFHSnetwork.com. I'm Andy Hayes, joined alongside my good friend and colleague, the expert, Matt Hatfield. Great to see you, man. How are you doing?
Great to see you. We already had one thrilling game, 42-34, Freedom and Highland Springs. These two have played some classics before. The last
two games have
been a one-score game. Who can forget the 2021 game at Old Dominion? Zeke Wimbush catching the pass on the final play from Jacob Thomas, rolling left, back, right. It was Heartbreak Hotel for Maury. They want revenge today. We'll see if they get it.
Yeah, they haven't forgotten about that game. A lot of talking this week. They said, we remember. For Stonebridge, they're coming off of a couple state championship seasons. They missed it last year. Back in the game again for the 12th time in 24 years. Incredible for Mickey Thompson's team. But this one looks like it's going to be a great one for the fans for a couple reasons. The history, also some great players on the field. Let's set the stage for everybody back home. First, let's start with Maury, the home team.
So many talented players on the field, Andy. And for the Commodores, a new starting quarterback this year. He came up from the junior varsity ranks a year ago, Autori Newkirk. He's got a host of weapons. Devontae Floyd's going to Duke. They have Fred J.R. Johnson, who was the region and Eastern District defensive player of the year. He's going to South Carolina. They're five deep at wide receiver. They have three backs with over 800 yards rushing and a pretty good offensive line. And for Stonebridge, Naheem Abdul Gladding, oh my goodness, he has been just a weapon, a playmaker for Mickey Thompson's team. And then they can mix up with different backs for Brendan Pena behind him. Troy Marquez, one of those key guys, along with Kaiser. And the offensive line, I mean, Caden Zalacki up front, 6'7", monster. I want to see that Stonebridge offensive line with that single wing blocking the Maury defensive front. That's the matchup I'm watching in the trenches today. Keep an eye on that.
Well, I can assure you this, knowing Mickey Thompson like I have for 20-some years, you will see the single wing today, and so will Maury. So that's a guarantee. I think a lot of it comes down to the other side of the ball. Billy Rice's defense for Stonebridge has been outstanding, giving up a couple scores a game on average. How do they match up against Maury's prolific offense and all those athletes over there?
You know, in the research on this game, Andy, the thing that most astonishes me, you talk about the single wing for Stonebridge, you know that Maury has more rushing yards in the two championship meetings with Stonebridge, whereas Stonebridge has more passing yards. You wouldn't think that would be the case, so I'm curious to see what Coach Rice does to dial up against that offense that Dream McCain has for the Commodores. Can you take away one element, whether it's the run or the pass? You have to take something away and maybe keep Newkirk in the pocket. We saw it in the Highland Springs Freedom game. Christian Martin didn't get his legs and mobility going until the second half. If Stonebridge can take away Newkirk's ability to scoot out the pocket and run, that can help them slow down the Maury offense, maybe a pinch.
Well, Maury getting set to run onto the field. Stonebridge is already out there. Stonebridge is the visiting team wearing their white uniforms. Maury in their all orange. And it looks like it's going to be a great matchup for you back home. Let's go ahead and get this some keys to the game today. We'll start with Stonebridge as Maury gets set to run onto the field. Let's start. Tell me what Stonebridge has to do to be successful.
Well, Andy, when you're playing a Maury offense that puts up almost 59 points per game and has hit for 80-plus three times, you have to take away the big plays, the 40-, 50-yard chunk plays through the air, also some long runs, too. Shorten the game. I mean, I think back to Super Bowl 25, New York Giants against the Buffalo Bills, Bill Parcells and Bill Belichick. What did they do against Jim Kelly, Thurman Thomas, Andre Reed, that explosive team? They shorten the game, win time of possession, and most importantly, they have to win special teams. For the kicking game, remember, the Commodores blocked two punts last week in their state semifinal win over Indian River.
For Maury, quick start, like you said, right?
Yeah, it's important because remember back in 2019 when they won, they got out to the 28-point lead like we saw earlier today with Freedom against Highland Springs. They held on in that game. Stay on the attack. Don't take your foot off the gas pedal. And third down conversions have told a lot in this series in their two previous championship matchups when you consider the fact that when Maury won over Stonebridge in 2019, they were 7 of 12 on third downs. The last time they played when they lost, 4 of 11 on third downs, had to go for it on fourth down five times. You don't want to have to be in a situation where you have to think about going for it on fourth down. Get it done on third down.
Commodores hyped up. They're getting ready to make their entrance here. Our game today is brought to you by Academy Sports and Outdoors. We'll tell you about our Academy Sports and Outdoors player of the game at the end. Matt and I will select that toward the end of this broadcast here today. But certainly something's got to give. Maury coming in, highly touted. Lots of Division I talented athletes who have commitments everywhere. Stonebridge has got their share of Division I talent as well. certainly with Miles Turpin going to Wake Forest. Naeem Arglading has had several opportunities, also several offers. So there's going to be some guys out there, Caden Blackie, and I know Mickey Thompson will have several more that play college football. But this is one of those great games to end the 2023 season with.
Oh, it really is. And Andy, if you believe in superstition, when Maury won in 2019, they wore orange. When they lost in 2021, they wore white. Today, they're wearing orange. So they went back to the unis that got it done for them. Stonebridge wearing the white jerseys. There's so many good players in the trenches is where I'm most fascinated. We mentioned Zalacki. Also got Christian Evans, who I know picked up an offer from Morgan State recently. Maury's got a couple of devastating players up front with Fred, J.R. Johnson, Ari Watford. You see Johnson, number 9 there. He towers over people. And remember to name Leslie Hines. Johnson and Hines have combined for 9 defensive touchdowns of the team's 15 this year, which is just an astonishing figure. But this Stonebridge team, like you said, Turpin, he's a two-way factor. I'm curious to see how those skill guys do against the Maury wide receivers and if they can get some big plays in the secondary. Sean Robertson's also been a guy that stepped up this year as a senior DB.
So there you have it. The captains at midfield to do the coin toss here. Talk a little bit about the talk that's been going on all week. It's been mentioned and discussed on both sides, hasn't it?
It has been. I guess it started with a social media post from the defensive coordinator for the Commodores, who was a great linebacker back in the day at Lake Taylor, and Mike Privet. He played his college ball at Louisville and Norfolk State. We don't forget Mickey Thompson. It was in reference to Stonebridge. I guess there was a lot of hooting and hollering and chatter after both the 19 title game that Maury won as well as the 2021 title game that Stonebridge took. And these two aren't really fond of each other. There's a respect factor from the standpoint of what each has accomplished to get here. You mentioned it. Stonebridge, incredible. 12th time in the title game. And Maury has quickly ascended to the top under Deree McCain. Hasn't taken him long to make them an elite contender year in and year out. 6 straight region titles. So these two aren't going anywhere. We might see them meet in the future beyond this season. But all that matters is right now, today, December 9th, 2023, Scott Stadium in Charlottesville, in UVA. And the weather's gotten better, Andy. We had some rain in the last game. The rain has gone away. This should be a fun one. And a lot of fireworks. I think Maury's going to try to get that early start like they had in 2019. Stonebridge, you know Mickey Thompson's got a couple tricks up his sleeve as well.
Maury will receive to start this game. We'll introduce the third member of our broadcast team, Jack Hayes. Jack, a lot of hype here for this one. We were down there near the field before the game. The intensity can be felt in the air, can it?
No doubt about it. These guys have met before in the past, previous years. So, you can feel the tension between these two teams. So this one ought to be a good one. I'm looking forward to this one as well.
So here we go. Our producer today is Celine Shane, 16 years producing state championships. We've got Ryan DeGerda on the top camera up here. Our man Owen Hayes down on the field helping to bring this one to you behind the lens. Andy Hayes and Matt Hatfield with you on the NFHS Network. A lot of fun to broadcast these games, and especially when you know both teams. Matt knows Maury very well. We know Stonebridge very well, so we kind of have it all covered here for you back home. Bulldogs have it teed up, and we're just about underway for the Class 5 state championship. And it's a low kick fielded back at the 14. Return up to about the 30, out to about the 32, and that's where Maury will take over. First down and 10, Damari Palmer on the kickoff return. A kicker that time for Stonebridge. McLaughlin falling down as he kicked it. He's been hurt. That's one thing to watch tonight. He's been able to perform, but he broke his collarbone, Matt, playing in the playoffs. And we'll have to see how he does tonight, although, kickers don't need their collarbone.
No, but he's a good one. Virginia Tech is where he's headed, and yes. Dylan Dastachurdy was a good one before him. We talked about that as a key in this game, winning special teams. Maury's taking a kickoff back to begin the playoffs twice this year, and they're coming out with 3 receivers to the far side, 2 to the left, empty against Stonebridge.
So, Torrey Newkirk, the quarterback, 6 foot, 185-pound junior. In the shotgun, 5 wides, a lefty. Back to pass, he's going to take off. And he's going to run it out to about the 39. Close to a first down, about 3 yards shy. We'll mark him back. It'll be a second down and 3 coming up here as you look at the replay. And this is the worst nightmare for all defensive coordinators. You cover everybody, and the quarterback can get out of the pocket and make things happen.
He can, and coming in, 33. 3,363 yards passing, 40 touchdowns, 4 interceptions, but he's also run for 7, 10, and 11 TDs. First year as a full-time starter. Not too shabby.
Run up the middle. Not much there. Past the 40 to the 41. And it looks like it's going to be a little bit short. It'll be third down coming up for the Commodores.
How about them clamping down up the middle? Jonathan Newton, 100-plus tackles this year. You see him, he gets away from the block, number 51. Also the defensive line holding well, and it's going to be third and short. Talked about third down conversion, such a big deal, but they don't mind going for it on fourth and inches if they have to as well.
Motion to the near side. Quick toss. And it's going to be caught down the sideline. There he goes. Racing to the end zone is LeBron Bond. Touchdown, Morey. That didn't take long.
No, it didn't. How would you like to be LeBron Bond? He gets the blocking from the outside, and once he catches it in the screen, it's house call. He did this to begin the game essentially on the second possession, third down against Indian River. He house called one, and here he is again, off to the races. That's his 16th touchdown catch of the year. He's a junior. He's got a boatload of Division I schools on him. They're going for two, Andy.
Yep, quick toss to the flat. This one's going to be no good, though. Stonebridge there. And now we'll have to watch the adjustment made here defensively for Stonebridge. On that last touchdown, we'll show it one more time here. It's a numbers game out there. Morey had three guys, Stonebridge had three, right? And if you miss a tackle, look at it. It's 3-on-3, and that puts the pressure on the safety. If he misses that tackle, there's nobody left. So we'll have to see if maybe Stonebridge starts to kind of shade a little bit that way with the linebacker, put some more help out there in order to avoid that dynamic. That's a tough play. That's why they throw it there.
You're absolutely right. You're looking for mismatches. If you can get more to one side or more people than a team can block, that's what it's a numbers game. And Daree McCain will then try to readjust if they make a shift that way. He can run the ball, use some draws, screens the other direction. They have a lot in their playbook, but that's the start they wanted here. Didn't take long, a minute change, and now Stonebridge has to be able to go to their methodical approach. You don't want to give the ball back to Morey quickly. So many guys can strike anywhere on the field. They're almost a carbon copy in a lot of ways, Andy, what we watched earlier with Freedom's offense against Highland Springs. You have 3, 4, 5 playmakers. I heard someone ask Lauren Johnson in the postgame presser about, well, you got to stop Jeff Overton. There's nobody on Morey's offense you have to stop because they have 5, 6, 7 guys that can do what Bond just did.
Again, Stonebridge is hoping that they can keep this game maybe a little bit more low scoring than they like to normally play. Here's the kick, fielded back at the 10, and returned out to the 20-yard line by Art Gladding. And that's where Stonebridge will start first and 10 for their offense for the first time here tonight.
Morey's got a pretty good kicking game as well. Andrew McClung has been their standout there. A lot of touchbacks booted into the end zone for him. But for Stonebridge, from their own 21, I think we're going to start to see that heavy dose of the single wing here. And Troy Marquez has been the main weapon for them in the backfield, having a really stellar senior year.
Single wing look here for Brandon Pena, quarterback. Back to pass on first down. Throwing it up, and is it caught? They're going to say yes, it is. Jordy Kaiser hauling it in. A couple Bulldogs in the area. And it fell right in the hands of number 11, Jordan Kaiser.
I'm not sure who that was trying to get it to initially there, Andy. That's his, I think, 22nd grab of the year. But Kaiser catches it. It looked like it was intended for Naheem Abdul-Rahim Gladding. But they'll take it as it puts him almost at midfield. And Morey's got, look how many bodies on the line of scrimmage here. As they've got 6 up front, 5 on the second level.
Again, Pena back to pass. Throws it into the flat. This one incomplete. A penalty flag comes down. So we'll see what the call is here. Get Mickey Thompson getting in the single wing, throwing on the first two downs of the game, trying to keep this Morey defense off balance and on their heels.
And you know what? For Stonebridge here, I think the key thing is going to be getting Watford and Johnson blocked on the edges it allows you to go more up the middle. That you see they want to attack the middle of the field. Morey has so much athleticism on the edges, outside the hashes. Now you're into Morey territory. Think about this. They didn't even run a play in terms of a rush attempt, and they're already on the other side of the 50. That's great news if you're Mickey Thompson in the offense.
First and 10 here for Stonebridge. Trying to answer that early touchdown from Morey. Here's a give to Marquez. Running room, past the 40, and it's down to the 36-yard line. Solid game by Troy Marquez.
Coming into this one, the Region 5D offensive player of the year, Andy, over 6.6 yards per pop. He needed 74 to get to 1,000. He's got a great chance today. You know, he's not one of those typical big-time burner guys, but he does run very patient, good vision, and looks like we have another flag on the play. Looks like it's very emotional and chippy here to start this one, and it's going to be on the Bulldogs this time. So one flag and a miscue on the Commodores. This one on Stonebridge, it'll bring back that long gainer.
It's going to go against the Bulldogs. Back to the 43-yard line. Stonebridge will have it first down, but first in a long, we'll call it 20.
But I think they can run towards Watford's side with Zalacki and also Nathan Moorhead on that side blocking. Watch them run to the right a lot as this game moves along.
Pena steps back, throws a dime out to the edge. That one caught. Good by Sean Robertson. Back beyond the original line of scrimmage. It'll be second down and 9 coming up. Sean's, good throw by Pena.
Yeah, Sean's known more for his work on the defensive side of the ball. 5 pass breakups and 2 INTs. But this is a very important catch here as he gets it with Levante Bond covering. It gets you back to the sticks, basically, 2nd and 8. And now it brings the running element back into the equation for Stonebridge here. And you know, they're so clever with these run plays. Some counters, some misdirections. It keeps the Morey defenders, who are so aggressive, on their toes. They have to be careful not to get upfield too quickly.
Ball's on the turf. Marquez has to go back and grab it. And now it's going to be 3rd down and about 20.
That's what you can't have, a bad snap. It puts Stonebridge where they have to abandon that running attack for 3rd and long. Marquez very upset. You see, he's fired up for this one. Where Abdul-Rahim Gladding could be the guy they try to locate on a pass play. And looks like, Andy, he's going to be in the slot here.
Yep. He's had some big catches here in the postseason, of course, all season long, but it looks like Stonebridge may have to take a timeout. Clock winding down, so Mickey Thompson will talk it over with his offense. 3rd and 20 coming up here. You kind of go back to it like we talked about with Highland Springs and Freedom. Morey is the equivalent of Freedom on offense. They want the ball. They want to strike quickly. Put you in a deep hole offensively where you got to come out of what you like to do. For Stonebridge, if they're in the single wing in the fourth quarter, Matt, then the game plan has been executed perfectly. If they're throwing the ball every down, then you know Morey's having their way. And that's really what it comes down to today.
That is really the bottom line of things, Andy. And Mickey Thompson's been around the block a little bit, shall we say. I mean, this guy won his 3rd state title just a couple seasons ago. 265 wins versus 53 losses, 16 regional titles, just some sick numbers. You don't have to get all 20 of it back on one play, though. They make it 4th and 5 on the other side of the 50. You can
go
for it.
He'll
go
for it. Yeah. He will. He doesn't like the word punt, I can tell you. So single wing look. It'll be Marquez. He'll take it. Not much there as he runs into a wall of orange. At about the 45. Good tackle there by the Commodores to stand him up immediately. Looked like number 56, Marquavion Morris, on the tackle. Well, so 4th down coming.
One of the guys that was missing, Andy, last week when Jack and I had the state semifinal 55-0 trouncing of Indian River was Isaiah Simmons, linebacker. He's back today, sophomore, who was All-State second team as a freshman. Keep an eye on number 14 as this game progresses because he can make some big-time impact hits for the Morey defense. They've got 7 shutouts this year.
Punt blocked. And Morey's got it at the Stonebridge 35. And the special teams for the Commodores coming up big.
Andy, Jack, and I watched this happen twice last week in the first half against Indian River. It's number 12, Leslie Hines. He's all over the field making plays defensively this year. When you worry so much about blocking Watford and Johnson, this guy steps up. He's got seven fumble recoveries, and that is the worst possible scenario for Stonebridge on that situation where you had a first down after that run by Marquez. Penalty, third block punt in two games.
If you're taking a look there at number 9, Fred Johnson. He's a fantastic linebacker. Also plays wide receiver at 6'3", 215. There's lots of schools here to watch in tonight.
When the college coaches came by in the spring for their showcase day, they were all drooling at, who is that guy? And that was a year ago before he had his breakout this season.
Long toss across the field. This one caught by Powell, and Powell takes it down to the 15. This is the old Baylor offensive look Art Briles used to do with folks. And then it came up to TCU, if you remember. They take those receivers, and they put them out at or beyond the numbers, Matt. And if you can get the ball to them, you got a numbers advantage. Tough, tough play to defend.
But if you do film study in your Stonebridge, you didn't see number 3 make a play last week. But coming in, he's got 33 catches for 609 yards and 7 TDs. So he's a football player. He can make things happen, and he's a veteran. Uh-oh.
Ball's picked up off the ground. Gladdy taking off down the sideline. Can he outrun the defense? Yes, he can. Naeem R. Gladdy to the house. Touchdown, Bulldogs.
Whoa, what a momentum swing that was. A scoop and score. Just when it looks like Morey's about to run in up double digits. Ho-hum, we're used to this. Stonebridge with a takeaway. And Naeem Abdul-Rahim Gladding, he's going scoop and score the other way. You're surprised Morey's guys don't catch him here. Newkirk's got a good angle. So does Clark. He does dive at the 40, but
Newkirk became the defender, and I thought he was going to run him down. But Gladding is fast. I mean, he is a guy that can get out in the open and go. Huge play. And the defense for Stonebridge comes up big.
Well, and he's had a huge postseason. Coming in, 39 catches for 795 yards, almost 24 yards per grab, 12 TDs. He had a monster game in the state semis against Motoka, but what a nice addition he's been coming in from New York.
Moved in back in the spring last year. And what an impact guy he's been. And you see it right there on defense. We thought maybe it would be on offense. But he makes his first big play on a scoop and score. And now the extra point to try to give Stonebridge the lead, 7-6. Connor McLaughlin on. And the kick is up, and it's good. Penalty flag down in the end zone. We'll see if the flag is against Morey. May have been offsides, which will most likely be declined here. Go back and watch that one more time as we see the penalty there. Again, it was just a simple snap. It looked like it went right through Newkirk's hands. Naeem R. Gladding picks it up, and now it's a foot race. And we know now that number 3 is one of the fastest guys on the field as he takes it to the house from about 80 yards. Stonebridge leads at 7-6.
Well, that's the thing. It's demoralizing if you're Morey, Andy. You were about to go in and make it a double-digit lead. It's not one of those fumbles that it's inside your own 15. You're not thinking you're going to score there. All of a sudden, Stonebridge takes the lead on you. You blocked a punt. So now how does the Morey offense react and respond to this? They were in a similar situation, still in the lead 7-6 in the Region 5B championship against Warwick. They responded mighty angry because they rattled off 34 unanswered to get to halftime up 48-6 in that ballgame. But, you know, Stonebridge's a different type of opponent than what Warwick is, and they've got championship pedigree and experience. They're well-oiled machine, they're seasoned, and it looks like the penalty is going to be enforced here on the kickoff, which means they could put this into the end zone. This is big because now you're not letting those lethal return men for the Commodores, one of which I think is LeBron Bond waiting back there to have a chance to give them decent field position, although the referees are huddling back up. Might they be... They're going to replay the down. Are they thinking about going for two here?
Well, they've done that in the past when they do have a penalty that puts you right on the one. They'll get in the single wing and try to punch it in, but maybe they'll kick it again. I don't know.
didn't really get the – did you get the actual call? Did they say it was offside?
I didn't get the call. I thought it was they moved it up a half an inch, but it looks like it's back at the two, so – or really the three-yard line is where the official's standing. We'll kick it again.
So extra point.
Now they're going to get to the Maury one.
Jumping off sides.
I think that was Simmons who got a little anxious.
I still believe Coach Thompson will kick the extra point because he wants the lead right here. Maybe he would have gone for two if it was 7-6 Maury and they put it on the one. I've seen him do
well,
that.
But, you know, in a game where this is not going to hold it at 6-6 stalemate to the fourth, I wouldn't think. If you can move it up a yard or two, I would get tempted to, you know, go quarterback sneak. We talked about Jalen Hurts, you know, the push from a yard out. Get behind that real strong interior O-line. Line it up to kick it again, though.
Here's the kick. It's up. And it's good. So with 7:04 to go first quarter, we'll take our first break. Stonebridge leads it 7-6. We're back right after this.
With great brands at the best prices at Academy Sports and Outdoors, you'll always find more fun. More of this and this. And more of this and this. So you can do more of that. And that. And that. And definitely some of that. While getting together for more of that, that, and that. Yes! Have more fun with great brands at the best prices, only at Academy Sports and Outdoors.
And we welcome you back here to Scott Stadium on the campus of UVA. Andy Hayes, Matt Hatfield, Jack Hayes with you. Our score, Stonebridge 7 and Maury 6. And it looked like Maury was set up to grab two quick scores after that pump block, but an exchange problem back there for Newkirk. And Naeem R. Gladding takes it to the house from 80 yards out. And the Bulldogs take the lead. So here we go. Stonebridge will tee it up. McLaughlin's kick back into the end zone, and that's an automatic touchback. And we were talking about this last week on the air, Matt. The value of having McLaughlin is Maury will not have many opportunities today to return kickoffs. I mean, most of them end up in the end zone when he's healthy, so you're going to make Maury have to go 80 yards. Now, we saw that may not be a problem.
No.
They did that. But that's a weapon for the Stonebridge kicking game, and especially the defense, when you got to set them back on the 20 every time to start.
It really is. And then you think about Maury taking the kickoff back to begin the game for scores against Kickatin in the regional quarterfinals, Nance Minerva in the regional semifinals. You know, you put it out there, and you could have a mistake, like the fumble or pick. Ball gets tipped in the air. The more times you have to try to score, the more things could go the other way.
Handoff in the backfield for a couple yards, and that's about it. That run by Melvin Lowe. 5'7", 175-pounder. He's a senior.
Well, and much like Mickey Thompson and Stonebridge, they'll mix it up with various running backs. Lowe, as well as Tamari Palmer and Leon Fatman Clark, all have over 800 yards rushing this year. Let's see how Newkirk in the passing game.
Five wides, three to the far side, bunched up. Not much there as the pass complete to number two, Devontae Floyd, and he takes it out.
You're not going to spin away.
Where's he at? About the 27?
Yeah, you're not going to spin away from a lot of tacklers for Stonebridge. You're not going to miss many tackles. Newton's one of the firmest hitters around, and now it's third and short to medium here. But how this passing game continues to evolve as this game moves along. They've shown the screen passes. Do they have anything deep in the arsenal right now?
Newkirk's going to run it himself, and a penalty flag comes down. Might be a hold against Maury. All right, I see an adjustment made already. Up there, you saw that three-on-three type of look. They've moved Naeem R. Gladding up on the line of scrimmage now, and right in front of the front receiver, which is going to keep that back a little ways from getting downfield if they do throw that quick bubble screen kind of thing. A little spot play, they call it, right? So watch that, Matt, because a little bit of an adjustment made by Stonebridge in the way they've aligned to that formation. And you saw immediately Newkirk didn't go out there. So a lot of times I think they have the option, right? If they see the matchup they like, they throw it. If not, he runs it. I mean, there's a couple different options sometimes with the quarterback. He's looking to see how you line up. Big holding call. Sets that one back at the Maury 17. So third down.
Empty
we'll call it 13.
Will they bring pressure?
Newkirk back to pass, trying to get it off. Picked off! Again, Naeem Orgladin. What a play. Stonebridge. First and goal.
He jumped that beautifully. He sees the crossing pattern, Andy, coming across. He's a little late on the throw, and Gladding was right there. Better spot than Johnson. It's more of your jump ball receiver than a guy over the middle in traffic. And what a first quarter Naeem Orgladin is having here.
Incredible. The first two big plays from Stonebridge's big play guy on defense.
And he's known for his offensive prowess.
That's
just
right.
Getting it done on the other side of the ball today.
Well, when they get to the postseason, a lot of times the offensive guys go over to the defense and they play both ways. Here's Pena sending Orgladin in motion, and they're going to run it with Marquez. Cuts it up the middle, and then he runs into a wall of Commodores. And that man you talked about a minute ago, Isaiah Simmons, was the first one to grab him.
Yeah, Simmons is a ninth grader, Andy. How about 87 tackles, 22 for loss last year as a ninth grader? He didn't play a week ago. Understand it was for some, you know, off the field personal situation, but he makes a major difference in the linebacker spot. Now, the Maury defense, this is their first real challenge. Stonebridge is in the red area. If you can hold them to a field goal or keep them out of the end zone, that's a huge win for you. Stonebridge wants to make this a bigger lead for them, knowing how lethal the Maury offense is.
End around, Kaiser trying to tuck it inside. Can't do it. Nothing there.
You've seen the Stonebridge offense for a lot of years, Andy. You wonder about, you know, they had that spinner series. Is that going to be as effective in this matchup today with what Maury presents, both on the line size-wise as well as athleticism at the linebacker defensive back spots? This is a real interesting play call for Coach Thompson and his staff here. Still third and about. You're at the 9-yard line. What do you dial up here? Do you let Pena get to the edge, some bootleg, maybe see if he can get something outside? And you know Gladding up top with Devontae Floyd covering him. 3 versus 2, that's the matchup you're watching on your screen here, should they go to the air.
I like throwing the ball to number 3. He's got the hot hand right now. Here he is trying to run a slant. Pena in trouble, sacked from behind. And the defense was the reason in coverage there. Fred Johnson gets the sack. Stonebridge will have a chance to add to their lead with a field goal, but Gladding could not get off the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, you can't block Johnson on the outside there. You're going to have to chip at him, do something extra there. They were kind of moving left. I would have liked to see Pena see if he could roll him to the right a little bit and see if you get something quick, because you have about 2 to 3 seconds against this Maury defense. Not a lot of time to get something off.
Fred Johnson closed on that in a hurry. The credit, Devontae Floyd, the corner up there that held his own against Naeem Orgladin. McLaughlin from about 33. He's got plenty of leg. We'll see if he can get it in from this distance here. There's a snap. The hold is down, and the kick is blocked. Live ball. Maury will pick it up. And a tackle made from behind, finally, by Keith Galway. And Maury will have it first and 10 at the 33. What a turn of events there, and what an effort. Oh, my goodness. I want to say 15 is the number I saw. Could that be Trevon Cannon?
It might have been Trevon Cannon. Couldn't quite tell who had that block, but an awesome job. It is Cannon picking up the football, though, we can tell you that much.
Great effort. It might have been 18. It was hard to see.
If it's 18, that's the backup freshman quarterback, Matthew Williams. I know one thing about him, he has an awesome first name.
Yeah, well, we can argue that later. You got to watch Hatfield on these broadcasts. He sneaks those kind of things in all the time. Here's Newkirk back to pass, and he's looking down the middle. There's nobody there. Caught. Johnson racing to the end zone. Touchdown, Commodores. Who forgot Fred Johnson? because he was wide open. I don't know if he blended in with the orange logo of UVA, but Newkirk saw him just fine.
Nobody with, you know what's very daring by Deree McCain? They had the last time he went over the middle get picked off on a cross. They said, we don't care. We'll have him go down the middle again. Those seams are there. Johnson showing why he is a specimen and a big-time playmaker. Both sides of the football. He had that sack on third down that forced the field goal that got blocked, and now Commodores back in the lead, and the fans wearing orange and blue on their feet, roaring their approval.
Stonebridge almost blocked it. We'll show you that play one more time, and let's figure out, Matt, where Johnson was lined up at and how he got that open. As you see there, he runs straight up the middle from the tight end position. Newkirk was watching him the whole way, and then once Johnson got the ball at 6'3", 215, he shows off the wheels to the house. Touchdown, Morey.
Because Morey has so many guys you have to worry about on the edges, Andy, at the receiver spot, there's no safety or linebacker help over the middle, and it was just a basic fundamental read, easy pitch and catch with Newkirk and Johnson there, and he's not going to get caught. 67 yards for Fred J.R. Johnson, the Gamecocks commit, headed to South Carolina in the SEC. It's his seventh touchdown catch, 27th grab of the year, and he's made the most of his receptions because going back to last season, he didn't have a whole heck of a lot of receptions, but he had most of them go for touchdowns, and you have to worry about him with his size, and now he's got the ability after the catch to make something happen.
Lead goes back to the Commodores, 13-7. We're still in the first quarter, folks. You might want to stick around. This one has the makings of a great, great game. There's Kaiser. In trouble, cuts it up, gets back to the 26. And Stonebridge will take over there.
So we've had a scoop and score, we've had an interception, we've had a blocked field goal, we've had a couple of long touchdown passes for the Commodores. We've had a lot in this first quarter. It's been fun-filled and full of exciting plays, trying to match what we had with Freedom in Highland Springs, where we had, you know, a total of 76 points scored in that one.
Well, I can tell you, folks, if you didn't get a chance to watch that game, you need to go check out our Twitter feed and see the replays. Jeff Overton had some highlight plays. Same with Carlton Preston as Marquez takes the ball straight up the gut for a few yards. I tell you, that one-handed grab that Preston made today would be a SportsCenter play. Oh. But then you'd have to say the same thing with Overton hurdling the defensive back for an 80-yard touchdown run. I mean, that stuff was unreal.
I have to give our photographer at Virginia Preps, Ray Williams, a shout-out, Andy. He's also the father of former Cox defensive lineman, Virginia Tech Hokie and Clemson Tiger, Jordan Williams. He got an awesome photo of the Overton hurdle with touchdown. I got to see his one-handed snag of Preston, which he said he also got here on the field at Scott Stadium.
Second and five here, and the direct snap goes to Tyson Miller, and he'll take it up. After a gain of a couple, it'll be third down and short for Stonebridge. Maybe less than a yard. And these are the kind of situations here where Coach Thompson won't even hesitate to go for it.
No, not at all. I want to see them go to that right side, Andy. I like the matchup. Even though you have Watford out there, you know, you see you have that imposing specimen who's one of the top 20-25 prospects in the country. Watch number zero. But they're now moving. They got Johnson on that same side with them. That right side of the line, it seems to be the strong area they can attack.
Marquez trying to get to the corner, and he'll be stuck immediately behind the line of scrimmage by Floyd, who came up from his corner spot. And not only are they putting Watford over there and Johnson, but they're also putting Kendall Daniels up there as one of the top safety prospects in the country as well. On that left side of, when you're facing the offense, right? The right side for Stonebridge to look at, but they obviously see that that's where Stonebridge likes to run the football.
Correct.
So they're putting all their guys that are a problem.
But they're playing head games, Andy. I think that you still try to go that way. It's making them go the other direction, and I don't like that avenue.
Short kick. It's going to fall about the 48 and roll to the 48 of Morey. And the defense for Morey does their job. Commodores have it back. First and 10, leading 13-7.
You know, and those quick kicks, you have to be extra careful with them because they can block those in a hurry. You know, last week, Indian River did it twice and had them blocked twice, and today they've already blocked a kick. I think Dereen McCain wants to get the running game established a little bit more than he has. He's had the two big pass plays for scoring strikes with LeBron Bond and Fred Johnson.
Two wides to either side here for Newkirk. On first down, fakes the give. Going deep again. He's throwing it down the middle of the field. He's got a man open. Caught. Touchdown. Joshua Powell.
Well, so much for getting the running game established. Keep airing it out with Latori Newkirk. He's got three TD tosses in this first period. The bomb is there. He got Floyd on the post, but they're going all the way vertical for the smallest receiver out there, and Joshua Powell. He's all of 5'8", but he's come up clutch here at the end of this opening period with a 52-yard scoring strike. And Morey's up double digits in the blink of an eye when it looked like Stonebridge had momentum inside the red zone on the interception, leading 7-6. Commodores blocked that field goal, and things have gone the other way in a hurry.
Extra point attempt by Andrew McClung. His kick is up, and it hits the upright, and it's no good. It'll stay 19-7, so some special teams mistakes here. But the Bulldogs on their heels defensively. Three long touchdown passes from Newkirk, that time to Joshua Powell. Fred Johnson has been in the action along with LeBron Bond. Bulldogs need to answer in a hurry.
How about the pinpoint accuracy of Newkirk so far? He's had the easy screen. He found Johnson over the middle. Now he's on the deep ball. He's been able to throw it short, intermediate, and long. And he's been doing it all year long. I mean, again, it's hard to think about this, Andy. Freshman year, he's at Bayside, backup quarterback. He plays JV last year. This year in varsity, he's already got 43 touchdowns versus 5 interceptions. And he's also run for close to 800 yards as well.
They've had a lot of guys transfer in here this past year, Matt. And they're playing a big role here tonight, aren't they?
Yeah, so many newcomers, and they've blended into Coach McCain's system. They've bought in. They've adapted to what's been asked of them. And if you're Stonebridge, you have so many holes to plug up. Difficult to keep them all because that leak will come.
Return gets out to about the 16. Iamar Gladden gets bottled up right there. There's Simmons again.
He's fired up. He is extra charged for this game. When you have to sit out a state playoff game, you come back for the championship round, you want to take out all that energy and emotion and intensity, bottle it up, and he's going to be going for years to come. College coaches were drooling over him in the offseason as well. Second team All-State as a ninth grader.
6 foot, 185-pounder, just a sophomore. He might have run out of the tunnel right next to Coach Pride. Virginia Tech is here tonight to watch this ball game along with his staff. Watching everybody here. End around, Jordy Kaiser. Kaiser with some running room out to the 26. I'll say he's down at the 25-yard line.
Really good block on Wofford. Really good block on Wofford on that run to get to the outside.
And that should end the first quarter of action, and it will. High scoring first quarter. Let's see what quarter number two has ahead. We'll step aside from a quick word with Academy Sports and Outdoors. We're back watching the VHSL Championships on the NFHS Network right after this.
This presentation of the NFHS Network is brought to you by Academy Sports and Outdoors. Have fun out there.
With great brands at the best prices at Academy Sports and Outdoors, you'll always find more fun. More of this and this. And more of this and this. So you can do more of that. And that. And that. And definitely some of that. While getting together for more of that. That. And that. Yes! Have more fun with great brands at the best prices. Only at Academy Sports and Outdoors.
Welcome back here to Scott Stadium. Getting ready for the second quarter of action. Andy Hayes, Matt Hatfield, and Jack Hayes with you. Our score, Maury right now, 19, Stonebridge 7. Bulldogs facing a second and three coming up here, trying to answer. Matt, lots of big plays so far by Maury.
And two block kicks. They blocked a punt as well as a field goal. The field goal they blocked really gave them momentum because it took them from behind to up 12 and just a spin of, what, four or five plays essentially.
Direct snap. Now it goes to Kaiser. Kaiser running forward out to about the 27. And it's going to be close. I think he's still a yard shy. It'll be third down coming up.
Really like the range and instincts of Isaiah Ike Simmons. You see him get to the outside. He's playing from the middle spot. Dylan Goad helping him out as well there. And these linebackers roam so well and freely. You got Daniels back there at safety. Jaden Ratliff, a William & Mary commit. Watch out for him wearing number 6 for the Maury defense. He had a big game last week. This is probably, again, two down territory, and you wonder if they try to do a sneak at some point because in some of these handoffs, double handoff action, get to the outside, Maury is there before they can even make a cut.
Marquez straight ahead, past the 30 on that running play. That'll be a first down.
Tell you what, they're going at it. The big lineman. I see 55, Javon Wynn for Maury, and big 50, Nathan Moorhead for Stonebridge. Check that. I think I had it backwards. It was David Rodello for Stonebridge and Bless Mack for the Commodores. Stonebridge wants to make this game more of a methodical crawl right now because it's hard to match Maury strike for strike, big play for big play.
Here's Marquez. Again, right side, good hole. And he's out about the 35-yard line. So good yardage on first down.
We'll take these little chunks, 4 or 5 yards. Let that clock run a little bit. Have the Maury offense on the sideline watching, a tad antsy and anxious.
Again, run again, right side. Marquez got a first down. He's past the 40.
Watch the power run blocking by the Stonebridge O-line. They're digging in and working here. 71, Caden Zalacki, Andy. He is pushing forward with some strength on that right side.
Bulldogs may just keep it on the hash here. If they can get these first downs, Matt, they'll stay there and just continue to run it. Marquez again, Miller, end around. Kaiser looking for the edge. Jordy Kaiser swallowed up at the 47, but a solid game. Call it 6 on first down at 2nd and 4.
Again, this is the patient type of approach, deliberate. You get Kaiser to the edge here when you've got them all sucked in, and now it's harder for some of those guys to get out to the edge when they have to worry about the direction going one way, you sway them back the other. Choose some clock. Important they finish us off with a score, but
you'll see Stonebridge run that end around, and you know they'll tuck it underneath for a few plays. And the next thing you know, they try to get that reach block and get around you, and they're to the hash and beyond. As Marquez going straight ahead, and he's got plenty of room for a first down and more, down to the 44. And so the running game is starting to work here for Stonebridge, a good sign for Bulldog fans.
Well, and I talked about earlier in our broadcast that the last 2 years, Stonebridge had more passing yards than Maury in the championship meetings. Maury had more rushing yards. It's back to the normal form for these two teams today.
Right,
Maury airing it out,
that,
Stonebridge running it. That was an aberration the last two times.
That's not going to happen today.
No.
Not with Newkirk's first quarter. Jack's got his numbers here. Jack, Newkirk's passing numbers to go in the first quarter will come to you here in a second. I'm sure they're pretty impressive. First and 10. Marquez and Miller in the backfield again. And a timeout will be called. That'll give us a chance to look over the first quarter stats. Jack, what stood out?
Torrey Newkirk was 5-for-6, 201 yards, and 3 touchdowns.
201 yeah. yards in the first quarter?
Yeah. First quarter
My
of action.
Gracious.
Yeah.
I'm willing to bet you, Andy, they played some good teams in Stonebridge. Obviously, Madison, Martinsburg, Quince Orchard of Maryland, good counsel, who beat them 41-3. I don't think anybody's thrown for Stonebridge 200 yards in a quarter in a long, long, long time.
Well, I'll tell you that a lot of people wondered why Coach Thompson was scheduling those kind of games back-to-back-to-back-to-back, right? I mean, to start the season, you got good counsel, you got Martinsburg, you've got Quince Orchard defending a couple of times, state champ. Madison been to the championship 2 years in a row. But in all fairness to Coach Thompson, I mean, he said, hey, look, I want to see what we're made of. And it didn't go well, by the way.
No.
But we were talking about this a couple weeks ago. And I said to him, I go, you're right there on the doorstep of beating Quince Orchard.
Oh, yeah.
On the road. And they got a big touchdown at the end. But listen, there were some positives in those losses. And everybody kept saying, hey, what is going on with Stonebridge? I'm going, look, they're doing these games this early in the season for one reason, so they can get ready for Amore later in the year.
He knows what he's doing. And think about that Madison game. They could have easily won that. It was a return kickoff.
Absolutely.
And Morey also, to their credit, they scheduled Wise, Highland Springs, and Dinwiddie out of the chute. That's not too shabby either. So they knew Stonebridge was into the tunnel for them potentially here in December.
Uh-oh. Miller fumbles the ball, still rolling around. And they are going to say it's a fumble. Morey football. Oh. Tough break for Stonebridge there. Great pursuit by the Commodores. It was rolling around, and I wasn't sure if they were going to call it down or not, but it clearly came out.
Tough break if you're a Stonebridge fan, but Fred J.R. Johnson, he's been everywhere. He had the sack where he teamed up with his teammate. I believe that was Marquavion Morris on that third down when they had to kick the field goal. Had the big touchdown reception in the first quarter, and now he gets a fumble recovery. So Morris making a lot of the timely plays after Gladding had those two big ones almost back-to-back. Now Morey's set up with great field position at midfield, and this could be another shot down the field with that passing attack in Newkirk.
Bulldogs have got to keep from giving the big play up here. Newkirk going to hand it off. And a run straight up the gut for Melvin Lowe. Solid gain, about 9 on the play. It'll be second down and short. And this is part of the problem, right? I mean, you worry so much about the passing game, and all of a sudden they start running the football at you, and you're not up there to play defense as a safety because you're worried about the pass. And here's another run. Lowe trying to fight forward for a first down. He may have it. He's at the 37.5. That should move the chains.
Well, just when you think they're going to throw it, they run it. And I thought the last series that would be their time they would use the running game, get it established, and they went deep to Josh Powell, who's not known as one of those deep threats, more of your underneath. And Doree McCain always seems like he's a step ahead in what he's going to, you know, call. Now the defense is on its heels trying to get this group slowed down again.
Hand off in the backfield again. Not much there. Helmet comes off. And now a penalty flag is thrown. Damari Palmer's helmet is ripped off. And the tackle. They may get Newton on a penalty here. Yeah, maybe not Newton. He missed the original tackle.
Could be one of the linemen.
Yeah, they might get Rodello. If that's 55, might be 56, I don't know, Evans. Rodello plays offense, so it should be 56. It's going to go against Stonebridge. Face mask, personal foul.
Puts them pretty much on the doorstep of the red zone here. And you have to pay attention to Newkirk as a scrambler in these spots, because he can fake the handoff, go around the edge. You've got Johnson in at tight end to block here with all those receivers on the far side up top. And they go empty with a man in motion.
Here's Newkirk, back to pass, tosses it to Ratliff. Ratliff spins. Check that, not Ratliff, number 8, Bond. Nifty move there.
Look at the pace Morey's operating with. They get this quick completion to Bond. near their sideline. They'll sub out a couple of players, a little bit of a personnel change, and they're trying to see if they can get Stonebridge a bit fatigued out of position to finish this drive off with another touchdown.
There's Newkirk in the shotgun, handing it off. Run straight ahead inside the 10 and down to the 7. Strong run by Leon Clark. It'll be first and goal from Maury.
Call him Fat Man Leon Clark. He's got a little wiggle to him. Different dimension than what Palmer and Lowe bring. But he's blending in well in his first year in orange and white, now in the red zone. He had a couple of TDs last week. Scores one here, it'll be his 20th of the year.
Newkirk will keep it, running straight ahead into the end zone. Touchdown, Maury.
We just talked about that two plays ago, Andy, when you have to worry about the receivers and then the back. He fakes the handoff, he keeps it. Very simple option read, and he's in for 6.
What a drive, mainly through the ground game. And Newkirk caps it off with a touchdown. Here's the extra point, and it's up. And no good. No good. We'll step aside for a quick break. We'll come right back here. You're watching the NFHS Network, and this is the VHSL State Championship.
High school sports fans, relive your favorite moments. Just click the shopping cart below the video player to get your digital copy today.
Back to Scott Stadium here on the campus of UVA. Maury out to a 25-7 lead over Stonebridge. Second quarter action. 6:25 to go.
I can tell you with a minute before halftime, Andy, out Liberty. Liberty Christian on top of Lafayette, 21-0, as the Clemson commit Gideon Davidson just had a 36-yard touchdown run, his second interception of the half. He's a two-way stud. So we're seeing a lot of him today here on State Championship Saturday. Landon Clark at Radford, Jeff Overton of Freedom, and of course Gideon Davidson at LCA.
Naeem Arkladding with the return up to the 24. Stonebridge needs to answer on this drive. Cannot fall much further behind here.
So imperative that they do, and not just that they answer, but I think they take some time off the clock, that they're able to get to their bread and butter with the running game. It was working so well that last drive until the fumble. They were moving the ball down the field against this Maury defense. You know Maury's going to do everything in its power to really sell out against the run, so there could be an opportunity at some point in the drive to pop a pass. Now, Gladding is their main weapon on the outside to get something done, but I wouldn't totally deviate from these runs up the middle because they've had moderate success with it.
Single wing look, Marquez straight ahead, couple yards. And the Bulldogs might have to go back to that passing game, Matt.
Yeah, I think at some point they will, but I wouldn't do it right away because the Maury defense, they're so opportunistic. We talked about the number of defensive touchdowns that they have this year alone. And if you make one mistake against them, that can just be the end of this ball game, essentially. I know you don't want to think in terms of negativity. Coming in, this Maury defense, 56 sacks, 22 INTs.
Here's Turpin. He's in the pass, and he's throwing it up for grabs. Kaiser was the intended receiver, and you have to wonder, is Brandon Pena hurt?
Well, he could be. I mean, they go to Miles Turpin, the Wake Forest commit, no more for his running and receiving skills, also with along with his defensive prowess in the secondary, where he's likely to play his college football in the ACC. But that's what I'm talking about, throwing it up for grabs. Maury has guys that can turn one of those pass plays into an INT the other way for points. So
well, I would say that's a pretty notable problem for Stonebridge if Pena can't go and throw the football. That makes him one-dimensional here. Here's Turpin. Host of blockers in front, and he's going to try to get that first down. Did he get close?
Real gutty run there. I think he got it just barely.
No, they're going to say he's stepped out of bounds shy.
Well, it's all about the spot here. Let's see what they spot it. It does look like he got hit right close to the stick. Yeah, where they're spotting it, I think you're right, Andy. He's going to be short by a yard.
So fourth down and about a yard here for Stonebridge.
And I'm not seeing Brandon Pena out there.
Nope. Fourth down, a go for it. Marquez straight ahead, and he's got it. The spot from the far side says he's got the first down to the 35.
Tell you what, Maury almost had him bottled up, but he got a good spot. And the Maury fans did not like it. They thought they had him stuffed. But they did get the first down.
I'd say he got a generous spot there.
He did. I think that's the angle. That's one where Dereem McCain wishes he had the challenge flag. He could throw it out there
right,
and say, I want to protest that.
They would have been up here looking at our replay, right?
Yeah.
So first and 10 with five to go. Direct snap to Miller straight ahead. And corralled quickly by Dylan Goad. And number zero, Ari Watford. Watford 6'6", 230.
And he's got every offer known to man. We talked about Jeff Overton from Freedom having a boatload of offers. This young man, he's been, ever since his freshman year when he was at Salem in Virginia Beach, I think he had three or four offers the first time I interviewed him, Andy. He had the ACC schools looking at him before he played his first high school football game.
Marquez almost tackled in the backfield by Kendall Daniels. He was able to cut underneath for a gain of a couple. And Marquez is playing hurt in this game. He hurt his ankle last week in the state semifinals. So you know he's got a little bit of pain going on to be running out there making those kind of cuts. Tough kid. He's had a great senior season.
Really has. And I look at the situation here when Stonebridge has to go back on defense. How do they stop the Maury offense? But the biggest thing here, another third down, you don't want to give the ball back to the Maury offense here. So this is important to get some type of positive yardage. A negative play is a disaster.
Kaiser looking for the edge. And I don't think he's got it. He's about 4 yards shy.
So much speed to the perimeter. Hunter Collins this time, number 20 on your screen. 10th grader. Comes free, and he had Devontae Flynn helping him behind, even if he had gotten past him to the next set. I mean, now it's another tough situation here for the Stonebridge offense.
Kaiser needed a little bit more of a block right there on the edge to get around it there. Fourth down. Under three to play in the first half. And the kick is up and away. It's going to bounce at the 27. And that's where Maury
will take over first and 10. Not sure what happened to Pena. We'll try to get an update on that. But that's big because the passing game is non-existent now for Stonebridge's offense.
It is, and we talked about, you know, Morey throwing for 200-plus in that first quarter. They have 2.5 minutes to go. All three timeouts at their disposal. That would have been a nice drive for the Bulldogs to get points on the board. You get it back to start the third quarter. Morey's thinking about ending the half and starting the half with scores, and then this thing is completely out of reach at that point if you get up 30-plus.
Twins to either side, pass the numbers. And this will probably be a run play right here. You see where Stonebridge is lined up. They brought the linebackers out.
They've seen us on film. It's, right. It's what their tendency usually shows when they go to this formation.
And there's the run. So, again, missed tackle, and look out. Off to the races, Melvin Lowe, still on his feet. And he's finally taken down at the 39. Check that, the 34-yard line. And this is what the challenge of this offense is. If you have the skill players like this, Matt, it means that your linebacker has to make that tackle.
Without a doubt.
Otherwise, your guys are out further towards those wide receivers or safeties. And if you got speed back there, you're in trouble.
Our number one key was minimize big plays. The chunk plays, you think about the passing and getting them. Now they've run up the middle here with a 40-yard gain from Melvin Lowe. And they're in business to score again.
Newkirk, under pressure. Take off. He'll run it. And he's going to slide down at the 20-yard line.
Newkirk using his feet to extend plays. It's what a dual-threat quarterback can really do. I asked Dereed McCain last week after their win over Indian River what schools are looking at him for the next level. He said, not a whole lot, but that's going to change this offseason with the year he's having. 6-0 at the half. Essex on top of Galax in the Class 1 championship out in Salem.
Here's the give in the backfield. Run to the right. This one for Leon Clark. And they're at the 10. First and goal here for Morey.
Up tempo they stay. They want to see if they can catch Stonebridge with a little bit of a personnel shift or out of position to strike and get in the end zone quickly.
Clark to the end zone. Touchdown.
Offensive line is doing work. We know about Stonebridge's tough O-line, and today Morey's offensive front allowing these backs and playmakers to do their thing and strut in space. All orange and blue for Morey right now as we see why this group has put up close to 60 a contest and hit for over 80 on three occasions this year. They have just so many different weapons that you have to deal with.
Trying to make it 32-7. Here's the extra point, and it's good. So with 1:20 to go in the first half, Stonebridge trailing 32-7 to Morey. We'll be back right after this.
High school sports fans, relive your favorite moments. Just click the shopping cart below the video player to get your digital copy today.
we're back here at Scott Stadium, 2023 VHSL Class 5 Football Championship. Morey leading it 32-7. And broken it open here in this second quarter. Amar Gladding trying to get upfield. He's going to get tackled at the 15. Aiden Ratliff slow to get up here for Morey. Hope he's okay.
William and Mary commit as Ratliff. And Andy, at this point, if you're Mickey Thompson, without that passing threat, Morey can just load the box with 8-9 defenders and dare you to have to try something different and exotic. And they have the playmakers to make up for it if they do get out of position and were to find a one-on-one matchup where nobody covered.
Well, it changes the Morey defensive mindset. They know they're running the ball, so everybody just sells out. Single wing look. Miller runs right into a wall there. Isaiah Simmons on the tackle.
Trying to go up the middle here, but eventually the Morey defense starting to buckle down on it. And another timeout's called here with 1:04 to go. And you know what Deree McCain is thinking here. He's thinking that we can try to get the ball back here before the half and add in another score, because he remembers what happened in 2019, up 28-0, and Stonebridge was able to fight and claw back to make it a one-score game, similar to what we saw earlier today with Highland Springs and Freedom.
Mickey Thompson talking to his guys over there. Go back to that field goal that was blocked. That was going to make it 10-7. And all of a sudden it turned around. Two plays later, it was 13-7 Morey. And they haven't stopped scoring since. That big momentum shift. And I don't know if it would have mattered. All I'm saying to you is those key little moments right there, the block kick and then the scoop and score for Stonebridge, you know, changed the way the first quarter looked. And here we are in the second quarter, and Morey is running away.
Well, think about it. If you don't have both of the block kicks, the block punt
right,
as well.
Right.
I mean, Gladding's made two plays that have kept Stonebridge as far as, you know, in front and having a chance, but ever since then they've been bottled up entirely.
Amar Gladding out in the open. Ball comes loose. It's knocked out of bounds. And Stonebridge bench wanted a face mask, which I think there was a face mask there.
Looked like there was. Referee went down. We'll watch it again here as they go sway him one direction, back the other. Kendall Daniels covering against Gladden. He just missed him. Wasn't his best effort on the tackler.
Right.
He's had better.
There.
Then you see Goad got him. Clearly, and the ball went popping out. He's very fortunate he was along the sideline there, but you think there's going to be a penalty there. And Gladding, right on cue, we just called his name. He's the one guy that can match up with some of these high-level athletes Morey has on the outside, so you have to find creative ways to get him involved on offense. He's done it with his defensive ability today, getting two takeaways.
He's lined up in the tight end position here. Here's Marquez. Straight ahead, Marquez still on his feet to the 50. And now to Stonebridge, try to stop the clock and keep it going here. Clock will stop momentarily. It does look like Stonebridge has taken their last time out.
How you like it if you're Devontae Floyd, a two-time first-team All-State cornerback who's going to Duke, and you get matched up and you see the big guy, I think it was Zalacki who was right near him, wasn't it? 6'7", you're playing up against him trying to get in run support. You're 5'11", you see that guy coming at you. Some massive bodies on that offensive line. You also got big 75 there. It might have been him, actually, Furkan Çabuk.
So the Bulldogs will have 46 seconds to go to try to get on the board.
Liberty Christian up 21-0 at the half. Your only game that's a single-digit battle right now, these three. It's Essex and Galax. Trojans were tackled at the one-yard line on the final play of the first half of that Class 1 title game out at Salem.
Some great games going on across the state today. We're glad to have the coverage for you here. Live from UVA, Marquez is going to take the ball, running right side. Got some blocks. He's out past the 50 to the 45. Stonebridge trying to hurry. Now, one play you got to watch for here, Matt, is Gladding sneaking out of that tight end position and running straight up the field.
Well, they want to use him the way Fred Johnson got loose for Morey from that tight end spot earlier.
Snap, right side. Be a first down. Will stop the clock momentarily with 20 seconds to go.
Tell you what, that was a big hit from Morey on defense. Wasn't sure if that was Daniels or who delivered the blow. Might have been Cameron Simmons. But I think did they throw a flag?
They did. Was it after the play?
Might have been
a late hit.
I think Stonebridge is signaling that it was on Morey. Got a little extra aggressive. And that's the one thing Dereem McCain is probably going to emphasize to his group at halftime is I know we're so supercharged to avenge the loss from 2 years ago at Old Dominion, especially as seniors, to go out with a bang. Don't get caught up in, you know, mentally doing something that can hurt your team. Got to keep your head here. Let's see what the call is from the official.
Seconds to go here in this first half. It's going to be a dead ball personal foul against Morey, 15 yards.
And now that thought the Commodores could get the ball back before the half, it looks pretty much out of the picture here. Stonebridge, even if you get a score, you say, well, come on, Matt, they're down at that point 19 or 18. Closest they could be is 17 with a two-point conversion. That matters. We watched earlier today a 28-point deficit almost get erased.
Stonebridge still in the single wing here.
Looking for their first offensive score today. They had that one scoop and score from Gladding.
Marquez gets a great block, and a penalty flag is thrown.
They're going to catch a hold. Might have been on Newton there having to block against Daniels.
Holding call against Stonebridge.
There's also
offsetting penalty. So they'll replay the down.
And that's another one if you're Morey. If you're Morey, you could put him out of field goal range here with that penalty. You get a penalty that basically makes it a redo, a reset with 14 ticks to go.
We see Pena now back in the game. And you see his left knee bandaged up here. They're going to try to kick a field goal for McLaughlin. From about 42 out. One guy's got a bad knee. The other guy's got a broken collarbone, but they're out there to try to kick it here. Let's see if McLaughlin can get it. And the kick is up, and it's going, and it is good. He knocks it through from 43 yards.
It's as long of the season. I think his previous long was about 34, 35 yards. And tell you what, they needed that just to give them some confidence going to halftime. Made it with ease, Andy.
I mean, could have made it from 55 easily, maybe 60. That was halfway up on the goalpost. So with 8 seconds to go, Stonebridge now trails by 22. Morey offense is able to strike quickly, but I would assume Stonebridge will not play a normal defense here. They'll be back quite a ways.
You know, and a lot of people saying, where's this Morey team going to rank if this holds? They end up beating Stonebridge by a wide margin. Commodores have a whole other half of football to play here. Let's not totally get ahead of ourselves. But at 32-10, they know you start the third quarter off with a bang. It'll take a Bulldogs team that's really been dependent on the run out of their element, and now it forces them to abandon what they want to do. And
I tell you, I would like to see Freedom and Morey play.
I think that's the takeaway from today if this holds, right?
I mean, you got to talk about Freedom in that light. I remember the 2013 Centerville team that went 15-0. They were pretty incredible. Westfield had a undefeated season in 2003 with Sean Glenn and Eddie Royal. You had all the guys from the beach with Phoebus and course, Highland Springs had some great teams. There's Ratliff is going to pick it up and run it towards the middle of the field. And that should end the first half of play. It does. 32-10, our score. Maybe Matt will do that at the half. We'll talk about the all-time greats. Let's think about it for a second. With that said, it's been an entertaining first half. Maury trying to capture the state championship. They lead it by a bunch. We'll be back. Owen.
Hey, conductor, how about something new? You played this last year. Come on, get your head out of your sacks.
Shh, we're trying to hear.
Well, I'm sick and tired of hearing your kid play the wrong notes.
Where's my kid solo?
At least you can see your kid. Why is my kid stuck way in the back? Hmm?
The conductor only plays his favorite.
I get her! That was so low!
You see if I did it?
Yeah,
come
yeah.
on!
Where does greatness start?
Here, in the classroom.
On the stage.
In the pool. On the field.
Where will your greatness take you?
To better grades.
To more friends. Yeah!
Be great.
Participate!
The innocence of youth. Is there anything any better? But soon they'll be in high school and facing all the same challenges you faced. How to make friends. How to fit in. How to be cool. We want our children to have everything they'll need to live fulfilling and productive lives. Make sure the kids in your family are among the more than 12 million participants in America who take part in high school sports or activities.
We'll be right back.
High school sports fans, relive your favorite moments. Just click the shopping cart below the video player to get your digital copy today. High school sports fans, relive your favorite moments. Just click the shopping cart below the video player to get your digital copy today. This presentation of the NFHS Network is brought to you by Academy Sports and Outdoors. Have fun out there.
With great brands at the best prices at Academy Sports and Outdoors, you'll always find more fun. More of this and this and more of this and this. So you can do more of that and that and that and definitely some of that. While getting together for more of that, that, and that. Yes! Have more fun with great brands at the best prices, only at Academy Sports and Outdoors.
How about something new? You played this last year.
Come on, get your head out of your sacks.
Shh, we're trying to hear.
Well, I'm sick and tired of hearing your kid play the wrong notes.
Where's my kid solo?
At least you can see your kid. Why is my kid stuck way in the back?
The conductor only plays his favorite.
My kid heard that solo.
You see what I did?
Participate.
Where does greatness start?
Here, in the classroom.
On the stage.
In the pool.
On the field.
Where will your greatness take you?
To better grades.
To more friends.
Yeah!
Be great.
Yeah!
The innocence of youth. Is there anything any better? But soon they'll be in high school and facing all the same challenges you faced. How to make friends. How to fit in. How to be cool. We want our children to have everything they'll need to live fulfilling and productive lives. Make sure the kids in your family are among the more than 12 million participants in America who take part in high school sports or activities.
High school sports fans, relive your favorite moments. Just click the shopping cart below the video player to get your digital copy today. High school sports fans, relive your favorite moments. Just click the shopping cart below the video player to get your digital copy today.
Welcome you back here to the halftime of the 2023 VHSL Class 5 State Football Championship featuring Maury and Stonebridge. The Commodores leading 32-10 as we bring you back in here to the booth here. Andy Hayes alongside Matt Hatfield. Good to have you with us. The final game of the 2023 football season. And Matt, clearly this one has gone in the way of Maury's fan base. They're excited. They feel like they're right on the doorstep of another state championship. For good reason. The offense has been electrifying tonight.
It has been just amazing. Altori Newkirk, three touchdown passes early on. You had Newkirk finding LeBron Bond on a third down when Stonebridge thought they had him bottled up. This is a big third and three here. You see the blocking there on the screen. He's able to dart down the sideline. No one's catching him from the 40, 30, 20 to the house. Then they had Fred Johnson pop out from the tight end spot, the South Carolina commit. Also got Joshua Powell. You see him nudging his teammate there. This was a big play, though, for Stonebridge. They thought they had a chance here. Going down the field with the pass play. They did get a completion, get near midfield. But that, other than that, they've been one-dimensional today. A lot of it to do with Brandon Pena getting dinged up, Maury blocking a field goal. They also blocked the punt. And the special teams has ignited the offense even more. Here's Powell making a catch as they're in the red zone area. There's so much to worry about defending with this team because they can hit you with the pass play, the quick screen, the intermediate down the field. This fumble, though, gave Stonebridge some life from Naheem Abdul-Rahim Gladding, the newcomer that entered the program from New York. He also had a big interception. And at 7-6, Andy, when he had the interception on the crossing pattern, you felt like the Bulldogs were right there, but the Maury defense answered the call.
Well, no question about it. And they get the big blocked field goal. We'll show that here in a few minutes as Gladden got him a pick right inside the 10-yard line. They go down and they get a big penalty here. They have to go back. They miss this third down, get sacked back there. And Pena may have been dinged on that play. Not quite sure what happened, but we'll update that in a moment. Here's the blocked kick, though. This would have put Stonebridge up 10-6. Instead, Morey gets the ball back. They get momentum back. And then Newkirk went to work, and he goes right for his big target, Fred Johnson.
Yeah, Fred Johnson making a huge play there. Nobody's picking up linebacker safety. All the guys are watching the outside with Powell, and you're watching with Bond and Floyd to worry about. He just goes all the way to pay dirt, 60-plus yards to the house. Morey with so many of those big plays for 40-plus. They had a run play from Melvin Lowe, a 40-yard run that set up a TD. And how about Devontae Floyd getting there on the outside? You know, Stonebridge has had more success running between the tackles with Marquez. Here's the bomb from Newkirk to Powell. Beating the defense down the field. Not a whole lot you can do when they get to that next level. And so many wide receivers. And think about this. Javon Wiggins was going to be one of their best receivers this year. He got hurt in game two, so they have another explosive weapon who's just a sophomore. The fumble, though, this was costly as Stonebridge was moving the ball at that point, and then this takeaway by Johnson allowed the Commodores to add to their lead.
Yeah, because if they go down and score there, it's 19-14. It's a different ball game. Instead, Morey goes right down the field through the run game. It's Newkirk knocking it in from about 7 yards out. And they go up 25-7. They've had a lot of problems in the kicking game. Otherwise, this could be a lot worse here. But they get the ball back under 3 minutes to go, and they go down the field again, running the football. And they score with minute and a half to go, whatever you want to say here, in the second quarter. And that touchdown run there by Clark. So now it's 32-7. Stonebridge gets a little bit of momentum going here, but they run out of time. They do kick a field goal to make it 32-10. And that is where we end the first half of play. And ultimately, Stonebridge banged up right now offensively. They've lost their quarterback, Brandon Pena. He's out. You heard that Miles Turpin is injured and may not return in the second half after that great kick there from McLaughlin. They got to give him kudos. That was 43 yards away. So injuries taking their toll on Stonebridge. They look to be a little bit too one-dimensional. They do like to run the football, but you still like to be able to throw the ball some as well. Morey, all they've got to do is just not mess it up here. They just got to play sound football. Don't give the ball to Stonebridge. No more turnovers. And they should be in good shape for a state championship win.
Ball security is the biggest point of emphasis if you're Doreen McCain here. Run the ball. Don't make any risky throws. And with Turpin being questionable to return, he's a wonderful football player. Matters to them on defense as well from the secondary. It really handcuffs what Mickey Thompson and Billy Rice, the D coordinator, can do for Stonebridge. And you know Morey, Coach McCain and his DC, Mike Perfect, they're going to bring the house and pressure on them, blitz if they can. This first possession for Stonebridge on offense will dictate the rest of the half, I do believe, because if they can score, now you make it to where it can be a two-possession game again. Touchdown, two-point conversion makes it 32-18. If you don't, the onslaught could be on and Morey can run away with this thing.
All right, we promised the fans that we were going to have a little bit of a debate. Now, I think Matt and I are going to have a full 30-minute show on this, okay? To say the all-time greatest teams in VHSL football history.
All right.
Now, listen, you know, I'm old. He's a little younger than I am, so we'd have to go back and actually really do some talking here. But
got two teams.
All of our coaching buddies right now are just kind of sat up on their chairs at home and said,
they're
what are they going to say?
They're texting us as soon as we say this. Go ahead.
We've got people online talking about this Morey team being it there. All right, we'll talk about that later during the broadcast. But who's your all-time great?
I've got two teams. Okay. And they're both 7-5-7 teams. I'll put that disclaimer out there.
Shocker. Shocker.
Well, the 1996 Hampton Crabbers, Andy, with Ronald Curry.
Right.
And then the other one that comes to mind, and Stonebridge saw this team. They beat them the year before, the 2008 Phoebus team.
Yeah.
That team with Taj Boyd and Sean Alston and Baby D, Dominic Davenport with the late, great Bill D, rest in peace. Those teams leap to mind. Now, you can throw up there Westfield's teams that have won championships. You can throw up a lot of different teams across the state. Oscar Smith's had some teams. Highland Springs had some teams. But to me, I think the argument, at least in Tywood, always begins with Phoebus 96 with Curry, 2008 Phoebus. Every one of the 11 players
on that
Phoebus
team. We're talking 5A,
6A. Sure.
Right. Yeah. Now, I thought the 07 Phoebus team, they'd won a couple straight already.
Yeah. But Stonebridge beat them.
I know, but I'm just saying, like, that team was loaded, too, right? I mean, Taj Boyd was there. I like those picks. I think Highland Springs is going to say, hey, what about us? You know, they won three straight.
Did they have one standout team of those five that have won it, though? They've had a lot of really great teams, but was one above the rest.
I still like the Centerville team of 2013.
Great.
They got to be in the conversation with A.J. Turner and those guys. Charles Tutt, as we get ready to start this third quarter, we'll keep talking for a moment on it. The bottom line is that they've been some great teams.
There have been.
All right, let's send it back out to the action here as we get started. Third quarter. Great to spend some time with you back home. Hope you've enjoyed our broadcast here today. I'll tell you, the 07 Stonebridge team, they were solid.
They were.
You know, you had Jaron Govea, Brian Slay, Zach Thompson, Patrick Thompson, and those guys, Ryan Moody.
Listen, Andy, as you know, with this kickoff return here for Gladding and Stonebridge, he got drilled, but he's able to maintain the ball and keep moving forward. There are some great teams that don't win it. I mean, that Stonebridge team with Jonathan Allen and Ryan Burns that lost to Lake Taylor was a great team that, you know, came up just short against a well-coached Titans team under Hank Sawyer's direction that is up there. And as soon as we said all that, we're going to get texts from saying, what about this team, that team?
What about 07,
and this team?
Mike Glennon and Westfield?
Oh, that's a great team.
That team was tremendous. But Sean Glennon's probably sitting home going, hey, man, I love my little brother. But let's not forget about Eddie Royal and I and Evan Royster, 03 Westfield.
And that was the Westfield team. That's the one that outlasted Phillip Sims, was it not?
It was. Yeah. That was Mike Glennon's senior year.
He
went down and beat Oscar Smith and at Oscar Smith, which may still go down as one of the greatest games to ever be played.
A lot of numbers in that game.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, you have to do a top 10 or top 20. Yeah, we can't leave it to just two or three teams.
Right, we didn't pick any. We just kept talking about them. Kizer looking down the field. It's got Gladding open past the 45, and Gladding has got it to the 32. So a little trickery for Mickey Thompson to start the second half. Morey thinking, hey, it's an all-run offense. Nope. How about the pass from Kizer?
Well, you knew Mickey Thompson was going to go into that bag of tricks there, Andy. And if Pena can't throw it, somebody else has to, is what you say.
Kizer with a beautiful spiral. If I'm number 11, I'm going up and saying, coach, give me the rock. I can throw it. He's back there. Maybe that'll open up the offense again for Stonebridge. Yeah, our inbox is going to be blowing up here with all the coaches out there
coming
watching.
In. What about my team? What about this team or that team that we played? It's coming. And this is where, you know, you want to score if you're Mickey Thompson here, but also you want to chew some of the clock as we talk about our keys from earlier to minimize the big plays, shorten the game, win special teams. They didn't do 1 and 3, but they have a chance to do 2, which is minimize the game. And Morey does not want to let up and stay on the attack. And third downs are big, not just on the offense, but for their defense too.
Marquez right side following his block. I think about Ocean Lakes, Coach Scott's team.
Yeah, with Jason Lewis.
Goodness.
That was an overtime classic you saw against Centerville. Was here at UVA.
I mean, everybody at LC Bird's going, hey, what about us?
We won all these
championships. We won 3 straight.
And David Bedwell had backs after backs after backs with the
Incredible. Scott Holmes. Incredible. Yeah, there was definitely a lot of great teams in those years. Trace McSorley's Briar Woods teams, which they played primarily 4A ball. There's Kizer, and he cannot get the first down. He'll be knocked backwards. It'll be 4th and 3, maybe 4 coming up here for Stonebridge, depending on the spot.
Well, it feels like we said this about Freedom earlier, Andy, that all these playmakers for Morey and Freedom, they're both averaging almost 60 points per game. But these defensive players, some of which double, some don't, they have a lot of, you know, pride and motivation to show that they're elite with the offense. They have to see those groups in practice every day.
So 32-10, we'll just keep talking about it here. We always like to argue about the greatest of all time. We didn't get into the greatest players of all time.
Oh,
I mean, that will get everybody going. We'll pause on that one. Hatfield, let's do a show, man.
We should.
I'm in. I'm all about it. Let's do a show. We'll have some special guests. We'll see if some of the coaches want to join us. They can give their thoughts about it. That would be must-watch TV, man.
Absolutely. And then let the fans get involved, and they can vote and pick their team. You know, let them, like almost like a little March Madness-style bracket where they can advance to see which team or player gets the undisputed title of the best of the best. I mean, we even get to see on Sundays guys like Juan Thornhill, we called in championships, not just for football, but basketball.
He's still got the best dunk of all time.
It's up there.
He and Dorian Finney-Smith.
Although Mac McClung says, what about me?
I forgot about McClung. Yeah, basketball season's coming up, Matt. Who's the favorite? You already got the beat on it.
I tell you what, there's going to be some great teams to watch out for. Woodside's going to look to repeat in Class 5. You have Class 6 where South Lakes has got a young man by the name of Jordan Scott, who is mighty impressive. Mom played some ball in her day, Christy Winter Scott, and then Class 4, Verona's trying to make it a three-peat there.
So fourth down is short here for Stonebridge. It'd be a long three, single wing. Jordy Kizer straight ahead, through the hole, cuts, and he's going to slip down at about the 12. That'll be a first down for Stonebridge.
You know, we haven't seen Jordan Kizer do a whole lot in the first half, but he's really got his fingerprints all over this first drive of the third quarter. You see he gets this on the fourth down play. You put Marquez in motion, direct snap, and I like the pull out here with the blockers. They're trying to get Newton involved, other pieces that Maury's defensive front 7 and 8 have to deal with.
So first and 10 for the Bulldogs. An important drive here. Kaiser back at quarterback. He's going to roll out. Throws it toward the end zone. And it's picked off. What's the call here?
You know, they could say this is whistle dead, which the Maury fans will be irate if it is. I think Stonebridge is actually declining something. It looks like they're waving off.
There is a penalty down. Penalty flag down on the field. Let's see. They're going to call pass interference. Maybe.
That wipes out the INT, and that's big if it does. Referees discussing this. This is a crucial call right here.
Crucial call. More so for Stonebridge than Maury. They got to get points on this drive.
Look at this great shot that Ryan and Owen are bringing us. We see all the fans on their feet here, and the boo birds are about to rain down if this goes against Maury, and I think it might.
Illegal touching against Maury? Is that what he called?
I think that's what he signaled.
So he ran out of bounds with the receiver and came back and intercepted it, but he gets a penalty on it.
And that wipes away the INT, which is the biggest part of this.
I'm not sure that's a defensive penalty can be called there, is it? I could be wrong. And I'll gladly say I'm sorry if I am. The head official is going to come over here and tell Coach McCain what the call is.
Well, he doesn't seem to be reacting with too much anger. His team's up 22.
I'm not good at reading lips from that far away, but Stonebridge is already lined up at the 7-yard line, so it looks like it's Stonebridge football. They're in the single wing. There's Troy Marquez and Tyson Miller in the backfield. Marquez straight ahead, still on his feet to the 3. That'll be second down and goal.
Another name we left out, Andy, as I'm already getting messages. I got to give Coach Q a shout out there from Green Run Assistant. Talked about Sean Glennon, Eddie Rowe, and Evan Royster. They beat that Lansdowne team with Jeremy Gilchrist and a young Percy Harvin. Talk about players. Percy Harvin's got to be up there in the conversation among the greats we've seen. But this is a big second down here for Stonebridge. Can they finish off this drive with their first offensive TD of the day?
Here's Miller running into the end zone. Touchdown, Stonebridge. Tough run from Tyson Miller. Would not be denied.
Tyson Miller is one of those complimentary running backs they have. He's not Turpin or Marquez or Kaiser, one of the first featured ball carriers, but he makes the most of his opportunity here, and now a two-point conversion coming to make this a two-point game, or is he going with the PAT, rather? He's going to make it a PAT in well, it is a two-possession game. He could make it a 14-point game. He'll try the PAT, it looks like.
So McLaughlin on to kick it. Kick is up and through the uprights, and it's good. So Stonebridge goes right down the field. And they get a break on the interception. And the Bulldogs score the touchdown to make it 32-17. You never like to say anything's over for sure, right? Bottom line is they're back within 2 scores. Here's Tyson Miller on the touchdown run. And that'll keep the Bulldogs with some hope here in this third quarter of action. 32-17.
Well, and how big, Andy, was the field goal before the half now? Because it has made it a two-possession game with this touchdown to begin the third quarter. All right, Maury had – the game they thought in hand at 32-7 when they had scored 26 unanswered points. Commodores haven't been on the field offensively in a little while. We saw Oratory Newkirk have aerial fireworks in that first half. I mean, really sliced and diced his way against that Stonebridge defense. But what can he do here after the 201-yard first quarter? He has just 8 yards since then, and he hasn't had to do a whole lot throwing the ball. They've used the running game a lot more since.
So Stonebridge will kick it away. You got to watch the onside kick with Mickey Thompson here. And there it is. And it's going to be fielded by number 16, Dylan Goad. I kind of figured that might happen.
He's looking to steal a possession, and why not? It's a point in the game here at 32-17 that you can certainly try that.
So the Stonebridge defense is going to have to stand tall here and get this ball back for their offense.
Keeping on that number 19 that's just entered the game, Elijah Moss, sophomore, top of your screen. He's a receiver they could target for a big play.
Newkirk back to pass on first down, throws it across the middle. It's going to be caught. Matthew Williams on the reception.
It's a freshman making something happen. He threw a touchdown a couple weeks back in the playoffs to the aforementioned Moss. Just a little dig route over the middle inside the 40 of Stonebridge now, and trying to get back that rhythm they had early on in the game throwing the football.
Newkirk going to hand it off in the backfield. Big gaping hole for Palmer. Palmer to the 10, to the 5. He spins. He's down to the 1.
Lost his shoe, too.
Just like that, Moore is first and goal on the 1 yard line.
Well, he didn't run the defenders out of their shoes, but he ran out of his own here. Watch him up the middle, cut back right, scoots there. 1 yard line. He tries to spin his way in. I think he lost his shoe there when he got tangled up with his teammate at the end, LeBron Bond.
Newkirk guiding the offense here. He's going to fake the pitch, come back to the right side, touchdown. And Morey answers right back.
It's a saying I've heard Hank Sawyer say, you got to answer a score with a score at Lake Taylor. He talks about it. Morey's doing that here. Stonebridge scores. They come right back and they answer the score with a score here with 7:35 to go. Newkirk's got 2 TD runs.
Extra point. Kick is up, and it's good. Was it no good? You're saying no good.
No good. They've had trouble on these PATs today.
They might as well go for 2 right now.
I think they should. And, you know, it is worth noting, Andy, that they had an injury to one of their kickers. Andrew McClung, who's still been kicking it, I understand, but I do wonder if he's at 100% kicking it. You talked about McLaughlin earlier. Maybe they're dealing with some injuries in the kicking game. I see Lafayette has gotten closer with Liberty Christian. It's now suddenly LCA 21-14 early in the fourth quarter. It was 21-0 at the half, so Andy Lynn's Rams making it a ball game out at Lynchburg.
They're right in it. So Morey will kick it. 7:36. That entire drive right there took less than a minute.
We got to give Joseph Smith a shout out there on Twitter. He says, I love the best team debate. There's so many we could name for sure. So he's tuning in. We thank him for tweeting us or Xing us, whatever you call it now on social media.
There's Kaiser, running room past the 25, tackled there at the 27. I mean, the thing about it, and again, there's other guys that you'd want to include in this from a media standpoint, right? I mean, Gary Hess has seen a lot of high school football down in Richmond. A lot of great teams.
Get a panel. We can make a little panel.
Yeah, look, we need to build this out. I mean, I think Matt and I are going to have to put together a great little podcast for you, the greatest teams of all time in Virginia, at least from the 90s on, right?
Sure.
Because you weren't even born in the 80s, so that
would happen. I was in the 80s, but I'm an 80s baby. Yeah,
I was 70s, so okay. We're getting old. Every kid listening was like, dang, these guys are dinosaurs.
Look, I already got one here from Libby told me, you guys forgot to include that Lansdowne team with Percy. Like we just mentioned a moment ago, but Coach
did,
Q did. Percy Harvin, he's as electric a player. You could do a top 15, 20 players of all time, and you'll snub a bunch of them.
I mean, that would be a tough one. But I might have my own top 10. I don't know. I may have already made that list. Just haven't shared it publicly. Here's Kaiser. Back to pass. Throws it. It's complete and immediately going down to the ground. Number 22, Robert Wilkins.
This Kaiser guy's not a bad halfback passer, if you will, right?
He's a great athlete and a great kid, I'll tell you that. He's athletic enough to play quarterback, but obviously he's been running the ball, catching the ball for a long time. So tough situation to be thrown into.
Well, Coach Thompson's had some great passes. We think back to Jacob Thomas a couple years ago, who was a superb all-around athlete. Ryan Burns, who went to Stanford. He's had some good ones at the trigger man spot.
Yeah, and Patrick Thompson, who's on the staff over there at Stonebridge. Kaiser going to throw it up for Naeem R. Gladden. It's going to be picked off, and there may be some holding going on there. Penalty flag did come out before that interception. And it looks like they're going to get Devontae Floyd. And there's the contact right there. He's played a good game, though. Senior defensive back has been active here tonight. So that'll give Stonebridge a first down. The top 10 greatest players, I really don't even know if you could ever do it. But I will say this, Hatfield, that, I mean, clearly there's been some guys on the big stage that you'd sit there and go, he's got to be in the conversation. Jeff Overton right now would be in my top five. Yeah. I hate to, I mean, just jump right now, but that just thinking out loud, in two seasons, watching what he's done against good defenses, I don't know how you couldn't put him in there.
Well, he's already shattering records, and he's still got a year to go as the Boo Birds are coming out. Maury fans, and I like to call there, but you know, you've heard Charles Barkley talk about it in basketball. There are bus riders and bus drivers. He drives the bus
He drives the bus.
Yeah.
Tremendous football player.
And how about the pass he threw today for a touchdown?
Right. I mean, it was, and I told him I'm sorry on the air because it was a wobbly throw. I mean, it wasn't a spiral. You know, and yet it was a perfect pass. It was right there where Preston could tip it to himself and go for the score. But, you know, I had to apologize to him because all we've done is say nice things about him. And yet, it was a wobbler. I mean,
he'll make a spiral for you next year. It's okay.
Yeah, in the film room, they'll watch that, and he'll, you know, his buddies will make fun of that. Like, nice pass, man. And then Preston will be like, I saved you, buddy. That was a wobbly spiral right there. But they only run for about almost 300 today, right?
Yeah. Just
I
remarkable.
Guess when you do that and you hurdle guys for an 80-yard touchdown run.
You see Brandon Peña on the sideline watching. You know this is bugging him that he can't get out there. He's less than 100%. And, you know, when you're dealing with injuries in a state championship, it's so tough to watch some of these young men that have poured out their blood, sweat, and tears. You need every healthy body available and then some against Maury.
No question about it. And Peña's played well this year. Coming into the game, only had three interceptions all season long.
Ooh.
The end around, met with a fierce hit by Jaden Ratliff.
I think Mike London's getting a good one. 12 tackles for loss coming in. That time, he just lowered the boom on the ball carrier.
I think I saw the entire Virginia Tech staff come walking in the tunnel before this one. And I know the UVA staff was here watching. It's at their home field. By the way, I'll tell you a little something funny. You ready? So we're down on the field before the game, Matt.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got the teams running out and everything. And, of course, this is the first time we've been back at UVA as Stonebridge takes a timeout. So we're down on the field. We're watching the kids warm up. And, again, UVA's got their, you know, their brand everywhere. Everything's going on. I look up in the sky right in behind the stadium, and there's a plane flying over the stadium that has a big VT logo, and it said, "This is home." It's circling the stadium. Now, if that's not a rivalry that continues on and off the field, I don't know what is. And 5 minutes later, we see Coach Pry and his whole staff coming up there to watch this game.
I ran into Tony Elliott on the elevator coming down. He and Blanda Wolf from UVA. It's great to see that the college coaches, you know, can be here to witness some of this great talent that's going on. And
of course, Virginia Tech, after they'd won their 15th straight, they come out for a big team photo at midfield, you know, after the game's over, and UVA turns the sprinklers on. I love it.
Hey, rivalry is real. Rivalry is real.
It is real. So third and 11 here. Kaiser back at quarterback with twins to his right. Newton in motion. Here's Kaiser's going to roll out. Throws it. And that one, Ratliff is saying he picked it off, and he might have. They're going to say he's out of bounds.
I have so many playmakers on this defense. We watch it again here. Guys are rolling right. Ratliff is just reading it the whole way in. And I don't know if he got both feet down. It's like he was going out.
He doesn't have to. Just one, right?
I thought it was two. He still had to have two.
No.
It could be just one.
It's just one, just like the college
game.
Okay. Yeah. So fourth down and 11 here for Stonebridge. 6:02 to go, third quarter. I got 10 seconds left here on the play clock.
A little surprised they're going here with the shotgun look as opposed to under center, the yard to go.
And they didn't get it off. Well, that's going to be a delay of game. So Stonebridge will punt it away here because it's now going to be fourth and 16. I guess, Matt, we probably need to open it up for a joint, you know, tweet or
they're flooding in here. We got Coach Steve DBU out there. Our man Steven Evans is our state championship team. Remember, our state championship at Ocean Lakes, number 6 in the U.S. with 5 All-Americans.
Yeah.
They're right up there with Kalen LeBourne and Giovanni Simmons and Jason Lewis, Levante Taylor. That team was stacked and loaded.
Another penalty flag. The reality is, you know, perspective. You've got to have perspective, Rick. You can't be all these guys that come out and talk about LeBron being better than Jordan, but they never watched Jordan. It doesn't work, okay? I mean, all of us old guys that watch Jordan play, I mean, we know who the GOAT is, right? And I love LeBron. Don't get me wrong.
But we got people saying, what about Bill Russell, Wilt Chamberlain out there,
right,
too?
I mean, you got to have some perspective.
The big titans of the game.
So you got to get guys who have seen it all. But the reality is that there's a handful of us out there that have been here for a long time watching high school sports. As this punt is going to sail to about the 50 down to the 47, maybe 45 before they pick it up. So you think about that for a second. I can take us back to about 2003. How far back can you go?
As far as covering, it would be for me 2002, that area. I just know you look up the record book, and this isn't in the conversation,
right,
but the 96 Hampton Crabbers, the
Ronald
things
Curry.
They did with Ronald Curry are just
insane.
Yeah,
right, it's insane. So what we got to have is a media guy that's older than us that could take us back into the 90s. Cool. We'll just kind of spearhead it. And the coaches, they're all, you know, they're going to chime in.
Sure.
I mean, we could talk to Coach Verbanek about his 2003 team, Coach Morgan about his 2008 team from Oscar Smith. I mean, go on and on. Coach Scott about his Ocean Lakes team. Coach Evans talking about that a minute ago.
We'll get on some of the historians like our guy Lynn Burke, who used to write for the Daily Press, Robert Anderson, who now works for us at Virginia Preps, did some for the Roanoke Times. Here's Newkirk.
Throwing it down the field again, and this one caught. What a catch by Bond.
LeBron
Bond. I've been waiting to do that.
Oh, man. He hesitated on that first jump, Andy, and he still was able to have the concentration and wherewithal to bring it in as he went down to the ground.
Great camera work by our guy, Ryan DeGerda. Tremendous. What a catch. Newkirk fakes the pitch, throws it to the middle, almost picked off, but it's Johnson on the touchdown.
It's like there's a flag on the play. Let's see what the call is. He got open quickly, and you see the late close out there from Stonebridge with Kaiser, but he is a big target.
Penalty flag down. I kind of sense a new show coming here, hopefully.
Waving it off. TD's
no
going to stand.
Flag. So Stonebridge. Looked like they had a beat on that one. Kaiser coming in, as Matt said, but Fred Johnson, he's 6'3". And Newkirk threw it up to him.
Well, the more and more I watch these playmakers from Maury, a lot of them underclassmen, Andy, the more they might enter this conversation of best teams. As we continue to get feedback, we forgot one of the best running backs from Eric Harris out there. What about Trevion Henderson for the Buckeyes of the Ohio State?
No question.
Out of Hopewell.
I don't think we can put them in the top for the top team, can we?
No, but he's one of the best running backs we've seen in the last 10, 15 years. And Overton is certainly doing some things that Henderson did that are right there as far as ooh and ah makes you.
I got a whole hard drive full of A.J. Turner runs from Centerville.
Well, listen, if you take Turner, I'll take Henderson and Overton and be fine, or vice versa. You're not going to go wrong with one of those three.
And Evan Royster, we can talk about all that too. Northern Virginia 757 battle continues. Right now, the 757 is getting the best of 703 Northern Virginia battle.
You know,
right
it's crazy. Henderson out of the 804. There's been some great backs with L.C. Bird and all those teams, Highland Springs. And Henderson, you know, he's still playing. He was a Heisman candidate. We might see him run on Sundays coming up. But this Maury team has a couple of players, Andy. We've seen a guy from them before go to the NFL, and Cam Chancellor was an enforcer for the Seattle Seahawks.
He was just pretty decent one.
Yeah, he wasn't too bad. Actually lost a heartbreaking playoff game to Bill D and Phoebus several years back. There might be a guy or two, or even three if I want to get real bold, that one day gets an opportunity to play on Sundays. They have some really big-time talent. We've talked about Watford and Daniels having, you know, upwards of 25, 30, 40-plus offers, and some guys on this team that are only going to get better.
End-over-end kick. Amar Gladding makes a cut, brings it up to the 25. And that's where Stonebridge will start first and 10. Tough break for the Bulldogs again, losing their quarterback here, so they've had to take their wing back, Kaiser, and move him to quarterback. And, you know, that's you're losing two positions right there. Kaiser's so important in the run game for the Bulldogs. But let's be honest right here. Maury's offense has not been stopped since midway through the first quarter, right? I mean, it just hasn't even happened. And that's just a credit to how explosive they are offensively. And Torrey Newkirk tonight putting up some big numbers. We'll get the stats for you at the end of the third quarter. But
how about him overcoming that interception on the crossing pattern in the first quarter? Other than that one miscue, what has he done wrong? He's been almost flawless.
Kaiser will hand it to Marquez, running to the right side. Cuts up. Got some running room for a first down. That'll move the chains. Troy Marquez has found some success tonight on the ground. This offensive line doing a good job blocking.
Well, trying to finish up with over 1,000 yards on the season. Marquez, a little nifty running, cutting back left, right. It's almost like you're the joystick. You can go either direction, and you make these defenders have to have head on a swivel. You know, Stonebridge is found some good runs tonight. It's just about executing the third downs and having a little bit of a passing element to keep the Maury defense honest.
Marquez again meets Ratliff in the hole. Gain of about 6. Second down and 4 as we approach under 5 minutes to go here in this third quarter of action.
Trying to direct his blockers there as you have in front of him, number 50, Nathan Moorhead. What a big factor he's been for Mickey Thompson this year. Two-way stud on the line. Defensive line clogging things up with 75 tackles, 8 for loss through the first 12 games. And you know, Stonebridge is starting to get some daylight running the ball. Like you said, it's just the defense stopping this Maury attack. If Maury doesn't score another point here, Andy, in this game, they will finish the year averaging 58.5 points per game as there's a whistle to stop this play. And it's going to be 5 yards backwards for the Bulldogs in the white unis with the blue numerals. But think about that. They don't score another point, 58.5 per contest. And that rages on the debate. We talk about all this past stuff. Who would win the offensive shootout now between Maury and Freedom is what people want to know.
Yeah, I mean.
Take your pick.
I don't know. I mean, we didn't get a chance to see Evans throw the ball a lot today. He might have gotten banged up a little bit. I mean, right now, the way Newkirk's throwing the ball, I think it would be a heck of a game. Who you taking?
Between Maury and Freedom? You know, I think if you're talking offense versus offense, I would tell you that I think Freedom might be a pinch more explosive, but I do think the Maury defense has more playmakers on it than Freedom, with not as much depth for Freedom. So I might give the slight edge to the Commodores, if that makes any sense in breaking it down.
It'd be a great game, I know that.
All kinds of people enjoying the commentary about greatest teams, whether they're from the 757, 804, Nova, all over the state. Even got a former Hokie Willie Pyle liking some of this stuff. So everybody out there is tuning in, listening, and a lot of interaction through the social pages.
Willie liked the conversation about the plane flying around the top, saying this is home, the VT logo. There's Kaiser out to the 45. Close to a first down. It'll be fourth down and short, it looks like.
He might be trying to get some of his Hokies, some guys to come to Blacksburg.
All the Hokies are listening and liking that story. I'm a proud Hokie. Graduated in 2000.
Well, and I think both of the in-state schools in Tech and UVSK is trying to get more players to stay in-state. We've seen so many great talents go out of state, and you understand when there's programs, whether it be the Ohio States, the Michigans, we talked about Henderson earlier, Florida State, this school, that school, trying to come get you. It's a huge opportunity, but you know, having these championship games on these fields like UVA today, we had at Old Dominion last year, Liberty today, which is having an undefeated, wonderful season. It's great exposure for those schools, too.
Kaiser rolling out, throws it up, and it's incomplete. They did give him the first down on that last running play, so it'll be second down and 10. I get it. I mean, obviously the kids that get recruited by these national powers that are going to play for national titles, clearly that's understandable, but I really loved it when the kids were staying home when they were going to UVA and Virginia Tech, and more so Virginia Tech for me. But at the end of the day, we love to keep our Virginia talent in-state, build up our teams, and go compete. It'll be interesting to see where some of these guys go.
My guy, Glenwood Farabee, Texan, former Indian River coach, D'Angelo Hall, senior year, Deep Creek. You remember D'Angelo Hall, former Hokie and NFL Pro Bowl defensive back, who's now doing some TV work.
D'Angelo was up in Northern Virginia for a long time. I was in school down there at Virginia Tech during the time that Michael Vick was there. And D'Angelo was just coming in there. I mean, they had a great run for so long under Frank Beamer.
Really did.
.142 and counting left here, third quarter.
Didn't go to Hampton High, but I just know this, back to that conversation, that those Crabbers teams with Ronald Curry, it's hard to go wrong with what he did back then. Here's the big third down run.
Kaiser trying to get to the edge.
Watford.
And Watford would let him out of there.
You know, he's gotten better, Andy, against the run. That was a question mark I think some people had about him. He's getting off the block here from number 56 for Stonebridge and Christian Evans, and he's able to get out to the edge there and make the tackle. Very, very important stop there for the Commodores. Now that Stonebridge offense might have to think about going for it. I know it's 4th and 10, Andy, but down 28. It's desperation time at this point.
Offense will stay on the field here. Let's see what they do. They got 12 on the clock here to snap it. Here's Kaiser throwing it up. Oh, and a catch by Naeem Arglading. Oh, my goodness.
And that's against a two-time first-team All-State DB going to Duke and Devontae Floyd. Naeem Arglading, he's making plays out of here, folks. He's got a lot of recruiting attention. And there's a bunch of schools looking at him from, I've heard, Pittsburgh to Boston College, this school, that school. He's a gem out there for folks. He's made it happen on defense, and today he's had the ball skills as well to go with it on offense.
Great job by Kaiser, too, to throw it up and give him a shot. Do it again.
And, you know, I mentioned Cam Chancellor. I can't leave out Vincent Painter, as Leroy Reynolds lets me know. Another former Commodore who I love so much out there and play in the NFL. Leroy, a UVA guy, so I have to give Leroy a shout-out. Don't want to leave those guys out. They help pave the way for these current Commodores.
Here's Marquez. Great to have all of you guys watching the broadcast. We appreciate it. It's always fun to interact with you out there. End of the third quarter, folks. Morey comfortably ahead, 45-17. Matt, that's what kind of makes this thing fun, right? I mean, listen, you can go on being all-pro, great Hall of Fame player in pro football, have a great college career, be your college, you know, college Hall of Fame, whatever you want to call it. But they always remember where they played high school football. And they always remember the community that they're from and the teammates they had. It truly is a remarkable thing that happens for these guys as they go through this time in their life. And I guarantee you, they're all sitting there, you know, like, as you said, up on your Twitter feed, they're saying, hey, don't forget about my guy. I mean, that's his guy, man. We went to high school together. I mean, this is the time, right? We always tell these kids, make sure you enjoy your high school years. It's the best to play with your best friends and your buddies in your community.
Well, and, you know, and Reynolds is a great story. We love the storylines and the takeaways from these big championship games. He was a young man that wasn't the most sought-after recruit out there, and he made a living in the NFL for many years as a special teams guy. There's always a role for someone out there, the next level, whether it's you're the Ballyhoo Division I guy, whether you're the 10th or 11th guy on the field and you're a Division III school's recruiting you, you go back to where it all started for you in your high school days, like you said here. And for these kids, for Stonebridge right now on the short end of things, down 28, or Morey up 45-17, they'll remember this as long as they live, playing about the state championship. And the stories will change, by the way, too. They might be that 10th, 11th guy, and they'll tell you, oh, yeah, I was the one that made this play to help us win or do this in the game.
Handoff goes to Marquez. He gets a block, cut at the 20, and he takes it down to about the 15-yard line. Good block there by Will Cross, the tight end. And a great cut by Marquez. Watch it again. Here's Cross coming around. And he holds up Johnson there for a second, and that allowed Marquez to sneak in there. But I think they're going to get a holding call prior to that block by Cross. Not on Will, but on somebody else right behind him. Well, it hasn't gone Stonebridge's way. I'll say this, 12 times in 24 years, pretty incredible for Mickey Thompson and their staff. The consistency throughout all of those years is really hard to match. Well, they've run up against another great 7-5-7 team. They ran up against Phoebus back in the day, and it was rough. That Phoebus program was something. There's Kaiser. Couple yard gain there. So, Matt, you've got the final down there in the Class 1 game at Salem.
Galax was down against Essex, Andy. If you remember, it was 6-0 at the half. Well, they end up winning this game 7-6, and I'm sure Jack and Helene will get a kick out of this. They were down 6-0. Galax wins 7-6. They got two safeties and a field goal that wins the game. A walk-off 42-yarder off the crossbar and good for Yandel Vera. How do you win a game like that 7-6? The Maroon Tide, who lost four games this year, Andy, they're state champs from 6-4 and a 5 seed to state champs in Class 1. The Cinderella gets it done.
Unbelievable.
That's what high school sports is all about. Who thought that coming at 6-4, right?
Yep, we have an injury timeout right now.
Two safeties and a field goal, and you win a state championship game that way.
Incredible.
No touchdowns. You win with two safeties and a field goal.
Well, there's a lot of ways to do it, right?
Yeah. They say there's a lot of different ways to skin a cat. Hey, Galax got it done the unusual way to win the title today.
Third quarter stats just came to us here, so we can highlight a couple things. Time of possession for Stonebridge in this game, 26 minutes and 49 seconds.
Oh,
but they trail 45-17. Morey with 9 minutes and 11 seconds. How about that one?
And they still got 45 points doing that.
Third down conversions, 2 of 10 for Stonebridge. and 20%. That's not going to get it done. Morey's only had two third downs all game. That's another problem for Stonebridge. Total offense, Stonebridge with 50 plays for 227 yards. Morey, 25 plays for 426. Here's Kaiser. He's going to throw it up. Three guys down, and oh my goodness, Naeem Arklatin somehow catches it and tiptoes to the end zone. My goodness. What a play. How did he do that?
So, Andy, you got three Division I studs basically surrounding you. You got Floyd, who's going to Duke. Daniel Swatch, again, a rat lift the Wim American, but just chuck it up there, heave it for this guy. Jump ball, go get it, young fella. From New York, New York to VA, and 6 points for him. He somehow tippy toes, keeps the balance. Even the camera person behind us has got his jaw open and is in shock at what he just witnessed and photographed.
What a play. That was incredible. Now, we were giving Overton a hard time about his pass earlier today, and I think he's off the hook. That was a wobbler from Kaiser, but Jordy got it there, and he gave his man a chance, just like Overton did today, gave his man a chance to catch the ball, and Naeem Arklatin did just that. We have to show that one to you again after this extra point. And they may go for two here to try to make it a 20-point game. Marquez and Miller in the backfield out of the single wing. Quick toss to Marquez, and he'll cut it up, and he's into the end zone. Tough run by Troy Marquez. He didn't try to get the edge. He just went right at him. So it's 45-25. The Stonebridge band playing. Trying to keep their fans in it here across the way. Let's watch this pass one more time. Jordan Kaiser, a wide receiver playing quarterback because of the injury. Throws it up. Naeem Arklatin somehow over the top of three Commodores, pulls it down and tiptoes to the end zone for the touchdown. Morey still leads at 45-25 in the fourth.
Sign me up for that, young man. He's got three catches for 97 yards, Andy, and he's also got two takeaways, including that 79-yard scoop and score. He's All-State first team in my book.
No doubt. And the other part about that, Matt, I mean, you got all these college coaches watching this game here. Number three is a player. I mean, he needs to be signed up immediately. Offer him. We've seen him do it on defense, on offense. He's as fast as any guy on the field. And he makes plays, man. That was a tremendous, tremendous catch.
That's another great photo we just got from our guy, Ray Williams, of Gladding against Devontae Floyd. There are a lot of big-time players going at it on this field. If you're a college recruiter or coach or even fan out there, you have to be really impressed with what you're witnessing from Freedom, Highland Springs, Morey, and Stonebridge today. And it does beg the question. We talked about all the history, and I'm sure there's some alums out there, fans, and those that played in the 90s and 2000s, coached in the 90s and early 2000s, say my era was better. Right now, Andy, I think the state of Virginia high school football is in great shape. We have six classifications. Some folks don't like that. It is what it is. But I will tell you, you're getting competitive games, you're getting some great matchups, and you're getting to see some excellent student-athletes put it all on the line. And we've got a lot to talk about and discuss and dissect.
No question about it. Another penalty here. Let's see the call. It was out of bounds, but I don't know what they're discussing here. If something else was called. Are they going to make them re-kick it, maybe? So 45-25. Morris says they're going to take it first and 10. No re-kick here, so 11-10 to play. Stonebridge trying to hang in there.
Here's a dilemma if you're Dereem McCain. Do you want to choose some clock and run the ball or go get a quick strike again? Because a quick strike might be enough here to be the dagger in the coffin here and put Stonebridge to bed, who's battling back trying to keep this thing within striking distance to an extent.
Here's the handoff. Run goes for a couple yards. Number 13, Melvin Lowe. Christian Evans on the tackle. He's coming back next year. He's going to be a really solid, solid prospect as well. 6'3", 280. Played really well.
Liberty Christian makes some history today, Andy, as they're the first private school to win a VHSL state football championship, doubling up Lafayette 28-14. So congrats to Frank Rocco, former Penn State guy, on completing the undefeated season there at LCA.
Handoff again in the backfield. This one to Palmer. Damari Palmer takes it out to about the 33-yard line. He'll be a half a yard shy of the first down. Third down coming up.
Commodore's able to change up a lot of different offensive pieces, Andy, subbing in and out, keeping them fresh.
You know, Matt, all the years we've done state championship broadcasts together, in all sports, right? I'll tell you, another great show would be the top 10 greatest finishes in Virginia High School League championship history.
Well, I think we had one today, but it wasn't the game we called. It was that Phoebus game out there in Lynchburg against Salem, breaking the hearts of the Spartans, and it sent Jeremy Blunt's team to a three-peat, and they're delirious.
Run for a first down past the 35. That'll move the chains.
But that Galex Essex game is not too far behind with a field goal and two safeties to win 7-6.
I think back to some of those great finishes we had, even in basketball, with you and I. But the three overtime games with Westfield and Oscar Smith, that has to be up there.
Well, Westfield loves overtime. They did it in basketball. We saw against Lansdowne in a state semi, then held off Woodside in a state semi. They lost to Colonial Forge in a heartbreaker, beat them in a basketball state final at VCU. Something about them and the word overtime that they enjoy.
Got to congratulate Kyle Simmons on a great career at Westfield. He recently resigned as the head coach, and I believe he's going to retire from coaching, but great guy. We've both had a chance to get to know him. I've spent a lot of time out there at Westfield High School following his Bulldogs throughout the years. Always a great guy to be around and a tremendous coach.
Class act. You know, three-peat for his team there, and we lost two state championship coaches as far as coaching for now. I do hope they come back at some point. Kyle Simmons at Westfield, as well as Tom Hall at Manchester. He won a state championship against Freedom back at Hampton University a few years back. He's stepping down right now. But those two are just great credits to the coaching profession. I hope they get back in it in some capacity, whether it's as a head coach or an assistant somewhere, because they have the knowledge and they help out kids in a great way.
Penalty flag on that catch by Bond. LeBron Bond, who's had a huge night tonight.
You feel like our guy Brad Nessler with Alabama, that call he had against Auburn, right?
Yeah,
Bond, LeBron Bond. He got to do that in that game in the Iron Bowl that broke the hearts of Tigers fans. And by the way, if Auburn just made a stop, all the Florida State fans wouldn't be saying anything because they'd be in the playoff and Alabama would be out. So that ends that discussion and argument and debate.
Don't even start that one up.
Fourth and goal from the 31. Have you ever seen that in your life, though? That's just insane.
It's just an unbelievable play.
Yeah. But it happens in sports all the time.
Got a lot of friends who are Florida State fans that are a little salty. We can't bring that up on the air.
No.
We get a lot of texts and tweets about that. But I'm excited for bowl season.
Coach Young told me off today on the podcast. He was telling me how they should be. He's upset.
Yeah, he's
very
upset.
And he didn't even go to Florida State or coach there.
He just likes to disagree with you.
He does.
Yeah.
It's his favorite thing of the day.
Delay game on Morey. 8:40 to go here in this ball game.
Only one team, Andy, has kept Morey below 34 points all year, and that was Highland Springs, who fell to the Commodores 23-14 back on September 8th.
Newkirk back to pass, nowhere to go. And he's going to be tackled out. Ball's loose. Stonebridge has got it. Newton was the one that knocked it free. And they've got it down at the 20. Check that, the 19 of Morin.
Hello, Newton. So you're telling me there's a chance for Stonebridge. They get a fumble recovery here. It's a little bit like that unfortunate bounce that went against them that Johnson recovered in the first half. Now the Bulldogs down 20 here. If you're able to punch this in and make this a two-score game, puts a little bit of pressure on the Commodores.
Great play by Jonathan Newton, the linebacker.
And Devontae Floyd wants some redemption against Gladden here in the slot. He wants to check him one-on-one.
Marquez with some running room and a blocker. Cuts it up. Touchdown, Stonebridge. One play. And Marquez for six. And Morey was not lined up properly there. They were all out of sorts.
You can't have that disorganized chaos there for defense if you're the Commodores. I'm sure it's going to drive Dereen McCain and his D corner Mike Privet crazy, because Stonebridge, it was almost a walk-in touchdown for them here. And with 8:21 to go, there's a lot of football still to be played.
They'll go for two. Handoff goes to Marquez again. Marquez is in. Two-point conversion is good. And Stonebridge. Well, hold on. We got penalty flags down. False start against Stonebridge. Tough call there.
Now do you kick the extra point? I think you do here.
Yeah, you don't want to be down 14 if you can avoid it, right? Here's the touchdown run by Marquez. Marquez taking it to the house after the fumble recovery by Newton. And the Bulldogs are holding on to hope here. They're doing this in the second half without their quarterback. You got to give a great shout out to Jordy Kaiser. He's kept them in it, and McLaughlin will come on for the extra point. Extra point is up and good. Our picture will be back up momentarily. Folks, hang tight with us. We'll pause and come right back here after this quick break.
I'm sick and tired of hearing your kid play the wrong notes.
Where's my kid solo?
At least you can see your kid. Why is my kid stuck way in the back?
The conductor only plays his favorite.
My kid heard that solo.
You see my kid?
Yeah,
come
yeah.
on.
Kickoff rolled into the end zone here for McLaughlin. So Maury will have it first and 10 at the 20 with 8:21 to go. We apologize for that. Had a little power outage up here in the booth.
But we power through the technical difficulties because we're just glad we're on the air, because you never know when it happened at the Super Bowl, Andy, with the Ravens and Niners 1 year. The power went out, but we're still here trucking along.
Yep, but we're back on here, so it should be no problem.
Now, how does Maury react here in a two-score game, 8:21 to go? They haven't been in this tight of a ball game since Highland Springs in early September.
Newkirk in the shotgun. My assumption is they'll run the football here and try to take the air out of the ball. Stonebridge thinks they are going to do that as well. Penalty flag down, holding against Maury.
Yeah, they're having a hard time on that left side blocking, and you see number 10 coming upfield quickly for Stonebridge, Tristan Putnam, senior safety. He's not a name we've called out frequently, but he's one to make the most of his last opportunity wearing this Bulldogs uniform.
So a holding call here. Let's see what they do. Will they accept it? Looks like they will. It'll still be first down.
Well, field position, Mickey Thompson still got, is it one timeout left? One or two? I'm not totally positive. I think the scoreboard up here is showing us with one. But, you know, if your defense can create another takeaway, or you maybe block a punt. Maury's done it as far as blocking a kick and a punt. Now you're backing this to where it's a one-score game, and now Maury starts to feel the tension. Starts to rise even more.
So first and 20.
LeBron Bond is hopping up and down on the sideline on the slot. He can't hear the signals or what Autry Newkirk is calling out.
Quick toss. Floyd's got it. Caught.
It's Chase Jeter right there, Andy. Sophomore defensive back, number 26. He backpedals, comes up, makes the firm hit on Floyd. If I'm Daree McCain here, I know the clock is ticking. I let it go down to about 30 with the play clock. Right there about 7:07, and I call a timeout before his third down, because you want to make sure, or it's going to be second and 12, rather. I would wait till the third down to call the timeout, maybe run a play here, make it third and medium, third, six, third and eight. You don't want to give the ball back to Stonebridge with six-plus minutes on the clock.
Newkirk looking, going to chuck it down the field, and this one is incomplete. No pass interference called, and it stops the clock. 7:09, it was intended for Powell.
The right call, Andy. There's a little bit of contact, but not enough to me to warrant a flag. He puts his hand at the end. It's not a catchable ball. I think you let that go. The way they've been playing and calling this game all day. Now, listen, you could call that, but to me, 8 times out of 10, you let that go.
Not a lot of contact, but there was
minimal.
A little.
Yeah. It didn't impede him from
catching
the football.
I mean, if you're a Maury fan, you're saying that's pass interference. Oh, yeah. If you're a Stonebridge fan, you're saying no call. That's a good no call.
You know what, though? The ball was pretty much almost done as far as the flight to the ground. You're right. That's how you view it.
Third and 12. Big play here. 7:09 left. Still a lot of time left.
And now the clock stopped with that incomplete, right. So I don't know if Daree McCain can do what he might have been thinking about on second down.
Newkirk back to pass. He's under pressure. Sack. An intentional grounding is coming up.
He's lucky that wasn't a safety or a turnover, and that is going to be an intentional grounding call as the official signaling it. That is the worst possible scenario for Maury, because it stops the clock with 7:01 to go, and the Bulldogs have all the momentum in the world here. He's trying to get the screen to number 13, Melvin Lowe, but he's covered up. Good job by the Stonebridge defender, number 56, Christian Evans. Let's call him out, the junior, reading his keys well, doing film study. Commodores have to finish this game. It's starting to look a little bit like 2 years ago when they had the lead and Stonebridge came roaring back.
Amari Kamara with the tackle and the near sack there. And it's going to bring up fourth down and forever for Maury. And they're going to be punting from their own end zone. Great pressure there by Kamara, who's a talented young player for Stonebridge, just a junior. Younger brother of Mikhail Kamara. He played at JMU for a couple years and now is in the transfer portal. He's had a great college career. Standing back in his own end zone. Andrew McClung. Low snap. And it's blocked. And it goes out of the end zone for a safety.
Charles Robinson, number 5, a senior linebacker. First time we've said his name all day, and he blocks a punt. So we've seen 3 block kicks in this game, and all of a sudden, Stonebridge has got all the momentum. This one is getting really interesting. Call up your friends and tell them this one's not done yet.
So now it's 45-34, and Stonebridge will get the ball back. My goodness. I'll show you that block one more time. Robinson coming in there. Scott free. And he gets his hands up. It's kicked right into his arm. And it goes out of the... I tell you, that would have been huge if they had been able to get a touchdown.
Oh, immense.
Well, they get a safety, and Stonebridge will get the football back, trailing 45-34.
And even without your starting quarterback in Brandon Pena, the Bulldogs have all the momentum offensively. They've used Jordan Kaiser in some different packages, rolling him out, trying to throw the ball down the field. And you have, in this game, as many good receivers as there are, arguably the deepest, most explosive weapon in Naeem Abdul-Rahim Gladding, because there's been no answer for him in this second half.
He's been a problem all game, not only on offense but defense as well. Interception, also a scoop and score, fumble recovery for a touchdown. They need him on offense right here.
Well, in the Maury defense, which has been great this year, Andy, 7 shutouts in the last 9 games played, only allowing 8.4 points per game coming in. 29 was the most they allowed to Dinwiddie on the road. 34 ready for the Bulldogs here, and you wonder about their psyche right now as Stonebridge gets the ball back with probably relatively good field position, you would expect.
Gladden to pick it up all the way back at the 25. He's got some room. He cuts out to the 30. 35 and take it down to 36.
Maury's going to win the state championship like they're hoping and planning to do, and they thought was almost in the bag at 45-17 with 5:14 to go in the third quarter. They look up 17 unanswered for the Bulldogs here, all 3 phases connecting. They're going to need their defense to stand up here, Andy, because if it becomes 45-40, touchdown and maybe even a 2-point conversion to make it a 3-point game. You talk about getting tight. Commodores will really be feeling the pressure, and it might evoke visions of that big lead Green Run had in basketball against Stonebridge years ago. Remember, they were getting looked like it was over, and it came roaring back. This team has a lot of heart. They don't die. Iron will.
Mark Gladden in motion, and the handoff goes to Marquez. The problem is they're not a passing offense, especially without their quarterback. As that one goes for just a couple in time, it's going to be a problem here. So Kaiser's going to have to figure out a way to get the ball to his target, Naeem Mark Gladden.
Well, and you also have to keep in mind the clock. It's one of those things where you want to hurry up a little bit, but don't rush to where you're totally out of sync or get a penalty.
Gladden in motion. He's going to throw it to him. And this one a little bit too strong. Almost picked off. Good coverage by Levante Bond.
Go back to that play where Levante Bond thought he had an interception in the end zone. Sort of swung momentum to Stonebridge. Almost had a chance for an INT there. Now Maury's trying to get off the field here. It's 3rd and 9. You know, if it's 4th and 9 or less, Mickey Thompson's going for it. Even if it's 4th and 9 or more, he might go for it because of the desperation down 11. But does Maury dial up a blitz here? Do they send pressure after Kaiser with those edge rushers? You got Leslie Hines. He's wearing 12 on your screen at about the 38-yard line. You got Ari Watford and Fred Johnson. Johnson's 9, Watford 0. A lot of guys that can come after whoever's throwing the football or whoever's getting the snap, we should say, if it is a run play. And you make someone other than Gladden beat you. He's the guy in a slot. Oh, we got a penalty.
12 men on the field. Illegal substitution on Stonebridge. That makes it third down and 14. Kind of look for number three if you can. And Maury knows that. We're going to double cover him here. Stonebridge will run it to Marquez. He's got some running room past the 40. Knocked down there. It'll bring up a fourth down and six for Stonebridge. The play of the game so far.
Really is.
Good hit by Kendall Daniels. Clock running here. Stonebridge needs to hurry. They got to get this one though. Here's Kaiser. Gonna throw it deep. And this one's gonna be picked off by Daniels. What an interception by Kendall Daniels.
Kendall Daniels showing why he's one of the most coveted athletes, free safety, versatile talents in the entire state of Virginia from the class of 2025. And that could be the play that allows the Maury fans to breathe a sigh of relief and go, whew, all right, we might be out of the woods. Might be out of the woods.
The thing about it is if Maury just runs the ball here, I mean, there's not going to be much time left, even if they have to punt the football. They've been throwing the ball the last couple series, which has kept this game somewhat in question. You hand it off three times here, even if you punt. Here's a run right side. Christian Evans with the tackle.
And you're right, Andy. With the clock situation and the timeouts, this is where you have been in the passing game, but you just run, because Stonebridge needs two scores. And ask them to score with under what will be 3 minutes to play twice, you take your chances at this point.
Every run play is going to take off 30, 40 seconds, right? I mean, it's a three-minute deal. And if you get a first down, it's going to be tough to come back. Here's Powell. He's still on his feet. He's got the first down pass midfield.
So much for the run plays, right? Yeah, they went to the air. They said, what are you guys talking about?
And they're just going to do what they've been doing all year. They're not worried about it.
A lot of
space. I
don't
have a problem with that either, though.
No, you know a lot of space to operate. And Powell has been really, really valuable for them. I think he goes unnoticed at times because of Bond and Johnson being those profound talents that make the eye-popping plays and the highlight reel catches. But I know Dereen McCain is going to be thrilled for this young man to get a state championship ring because he's one of those lunch pail type of guys at receiver, which sounds weird to say, but he brings it. And he doesn't mind being the under-recruited, under-the-radar type of guy.
Carry up the middle for Clark. Gain of about five.
You know, we went from Maury being talked about with some of the greatest teams in Virginia high school football history, Andy, to, oh, my goodness, are they going to hang on and win this thing?
Yep.
I think a lot of that was Stonebridge. You know, their pride and resiliency and determination in that program not backing down.
Newkirk looks like he's taller than 6 foot to me. Watching him up here, Matt.
Could be. Maybe they measured him in August and he grew an inch, right?
I know he's still probably growing. He just looks like he's a tall guy. He's throwing the ball really well tonight. His numbers are going to be really good at the end of the night.
And I tell you what, he doesn't dwell on mistakes. Here he is as a runner again. This was the one thing I told Dereen McCain in the postgame about a week or two ago. I said, Coach, I saw him in 7-on-7, saw him in the offseason, saw him early in the season. I didn't know with Kendall Daniels expected to be the quarterback. He got hurt last year in the playoffs. He missed the state championship game against Highland Springs, as did running back Peyton Jones, now a ball carrier at Duke in the ACC, how they would be at quarterback with Newkirk. I knew he had tools and he had ability, but he's a better runner than I thought, and I think that has given their whole offense a new dimension. And Daniels has played a little bit at QB in a couple of instances, but my goodness, they can do so many things with him as the quarterback.
So first, check that. Yeah, first and 10 here for Maury. And I'll hand it off up the middle here for Melvin Lowe, who's dropped back at the line of scrimmage, maybe a yard gain. It'll be second and 7. Second and 9, they're going to call it. Only a yard gain.
I'll tell you what debate is going to rage on, Andy, is which Maury team was better, the 2019 team that had a bunch of studs like Keandre Lambert-Smith, who's now at Penn State, and C.J. Beasley, and
this team is better than
Tyshawn Granger, and I think that this team is going to claim the argument, because why? They had a tougher schedule. They played Wise and Highland Springs and Dinwiddie and Stonebridge on their way to 15-0. It feels like this team a bit more explosive. Well, that 2019 team, those players out there maybe watching, listening, will say, Hatfield, you don't know what you're talking about. You're crazy.
I called both of the games. I've only seen one game apiece, right? Both of them against Stonebridge, but this team here is more explosive offensively. You got more weapons. And that's not taking anything away from the young man that went to Penn State. He's a great talent. He was a difference maker in that game that day a few years ago. But this team has a lot of guys that can hurt you.
Yeah, that team had some good frontline players. It feels like the seconds, the reserves for this team, there's no drop-off, whereas with that team, there might have been a little bit more of a drop-off when you subbed out some personnel.
So getting down to the last minute and 17 seconds here. Timeout by Stonebridge. It's going to be 3rd and 9. Then get a stop here. Get the ball back. And thinking, hey, maybe we score and onside kick the field goal and win it. I don't think you would have said that to him 20 minutes ago.
No. When it was 45-17, people might have turned this off and said, I'm not going to bed at 7:45 at night, but I'm going to go do something else or watch another game. And they might have looked on social or had someone text them and said, hold on, this game's interesting now, go back to it. The thing is, if they do get the ball back, you have an idea who they're going to target, and that's number 3, who has been just dazzling in this game for Stonebridge. Even if it does end up in a defeat for them, he has left it all on the field tonight.
So 3rd and 9. There's Newkirk. He's got it. And he's going to have the first down. All the way down to the 23-yard line. And I believe that'll move the chains. Well, I take that back. They may have to measure.
You know, Maury could end up going the last 17 minutes without scoring and still win the state championship game. They put up 45 points, though, Andy, in the first, 31 minutes.
Two and a half quarters.
Yeah, 31 minutes of the game.
Well, I'll say this. I commend the Bulldogs for continuing to stay in the fight. That some adversity, losing not only Brandon Pena but also Miles Turpin. Those are two big parts of your team that have not played since the second quarter, and they found a way to come back and get in this ball game. Jordan Kaiser moving to quarterback. Naeem Arkladding just picking up the team on his back and saying, just throw me the ball, just get me the rock. Well, find a way.
And to think, Andy, this team didn't have a win on the field until October, because they started out 1-4. The lone win was a forfeit over Woodgrove. They fell to Martinsburg by 34, and Good Counsel beat them by 38. To go from 1-4 to 9-4, not a lot of programs would have rebounded the way that they have. And even in this game, I think it capsules their whole season what happened tonight. They were down 45-17, but they found a way to battle back. really typified it in so many ways.
It's going to be fourth down here. They're going to say 109 on the clock here. So
you don't kick the field goal here. You don't punt it. You obviously go for it here on fourth and inches. And you know what I'm doing? I'm putting Daniels in to sneak this. I know Newkirk's your back. I'm putting Kendall Daniels in here. He didn't play in last year's state championship. He had the diving INT. I'm letting him sneak it up under center. And against the big Stonebridge line, you know, they have so many large guys in the trenches. I'm telling my offensive line, those guys up front. And, again, they've got three first-team all-region performers on this O-line with Christian Meatball Murphy. Love that nickname. Corey Sanderlin and Javon Wynn. I'm running behind you guys to finish the deal. I'm trusting in you guys. And honestly, it's not a scary situation. You're up 11 with a minute 09 to go. You should be able to convert this.
Well, this was Jalen Hurts and the Philadelphia Eagles. You just say, no problem. We got it.
Tush push.
You get 3 yards and a cloud of dust on the tush push.
Yeah. Right? Who's snapping this sucker? We got number 51 here, Joshua Bowe, Jr. Give me a clean snap. But they're going to leave Newkirk out there, not Daniels. And they're going to go shotgun, it looks like, unless they snap it to one of the upbacks. Waiting for the play clock to go down to one. Well, here he goes.
They'll take a delayed game. Or will they? No, they will. They didn't call timeout.
A little surprise there because it backs you up 5 yards. I would have let, you know, called the timeout or let him sneak it. I still would have gone with number 5 to sneak it. Let that guy. He might have thought about scoring if he tried to sneak it, though. I think that's his mindset, don't you?
Yeah.
Coach, I'm not sneaking. I want to score.
The fake sneak.
Yeah. The fake sneak.
It was Dan Marino play. And then I'm
gonna
drop back.
Oh, the Jets fans are still having heartburn over that. As if Aaron Rodgers going down in week one wasn't enough. And by the way, he was my fantasy football quarterback this year, so you know how I feel about that.
Yeah. Ugh. Jack's fantasy football quarterback, too.
Oh, Jack and me were in the same boat. That was rough for us. And I'm not even a Jets fan. I'm a Cardinals fan. It's been a rough year from that perspective. Oh, that's a long story.
Jack's a Browns fan. Oh. You're a Cardinals fan. I just feel sorry for both of you.
Yeah. Not a lot of celebrating for us.
I mean, how do you latch on to those two teams? You know what I mean? Like, I mean, what happened in your childhood where you go, you know what? I really like this Cardinals team.
Well, listen, I have some family that are out there in the desert. Long story short, we were so close with Kurt Warner and Larry Fitzgerald, and then the Steelers broke our heart. We were blaming it on Aaron Francisco there for taking a bad angle on a tackle. That's another story for another time because we've got an important fourth down to settle the state championship game.
I mean, Jack has no tie to the Browns, and he just latched onto him. I was like, why would you, of all teams?
See, I thought it was because of Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoa from Bethel High School and Juan Thornhill from Alta Vista.
Well, now he's there, yeah. Here's the fourth down play. Newkirk going to chuck it towards the end zone. Incomplete. Through the hands.
It's Elijah
Matthew,
Moss.
What is it, 19?
Yeah, Elijah Moss. We talked about him earlier, but that was what you would think is a touchdown ordinarily, and now Stonebridge has 36 seconds. It's going to be hard to score 11 in 36 seconds, although we've seen crazier things, perhaps.
You see Patrick Thompson calling the play out over there across the way. Former Stonebridge great. That quarterback has a state championship ring back in 2007.
Even had Dylan Destichurti tweet at me, let's go, boys. He's watching it, rooting on his former team.
Yep.
And they could use Dylan's leg right now for a game-winning field goal, but they need not just a field goal, they need two touchdowns, honestly.
Throw the ball to number 3. Morey knows that. They're double covering him. In motion, they'll give it to him. And he'll go straight to the ground. No timeouts left. The clock is going to be a problem here. Stonebridge better hurry.
Ari Watford, you knew he would make a big play before his day was done, and there's the tackle for loss from one of the best 2025 edge rushers in the nation.
17 seconds left. And Stonebridge is taking forever. It'll be the last play of the game. This one picked off by Daniels. Kendall Daniels. And that's it. The Maury Commodores are your 2023 DHSL state champions. And it ends on a Kendall Daniels interception, his second of the day.
Five alive, Andy. Number five makes the INT to seal it, his second pick of the quarter, and it's the second state championship in 5 years for Doreen McCain's Commodores as they finish off the 15-0 perfect season like they did in 2019 when they beat the Bulldogs at Hampton U. They get some revenge, a measure of it, from the 2021 loss at ODU when they fell in the final play of the game. It got tight. They were up 45-17. Stonebridge rallied back, but ultimately they accomplished the mission that was set out when they lost on that tough December Saturday a year ago to Highland Springs.
So 45-34, the final score. Congratulations to Maury. We do have some penalty flags down on the field, so not sure if we're done here.
Looks like they're declining whatever it is as the Maury sideline is going to erupt.
So they are saying it's over with. All right, it's time for us to tell you who our Academy Sports and Outdoors Player of the Game is. Matt, I'm going to let you pick it since your team from the 757 victorious here tonight. Who are you taking?
Well, listen, I do want to shout out Naeem Gladding in a defeat. I think he had a great game for the Bulldogs. You could go a lot of different ways. LeBron Bond was great. Fred Johnson was great. Two fourth-quarter interceptions for Kendall Daniels, but Autori Newkirk, even though he had a couple of miscues, he was laser-like. To be 9 of 10 with 279 yards passing and four TDs through three quarters of play and two TD runs, how do you not give it to a quarterback that had six touchdowns produced with his hands involved on every one of them, either throwing it or running it?
No question about it. I agree. You go with number seven, and you can't go wrong. So Autori Newkirk, the Academy Sports and Outdoors Player of the Game, and you see him right there on your camera shot.
And not a bad move up from JV to varsity, huh? You think they made the right call with that? It was a JV quarterback last year, now the varsity starter.
I'd say that's a good way to get into some varsity play, right?
I think he had eight touchdowns in a JV game last year throwing the football. So that probably gave the coaching staff an idea he could get this done.
Well, and he's got a great arm. I mean, he's thrown the ball several times tonight, over 40, 50 yards on the money. So Autori Newkirk our player of the game here tonight. Congratulations to him. We'll get the final numbers. I guarantee it's over 300 yards passing, as Matt said.
Well, and Andy, when you add up his season stats now, he finishes up the season with 44 touchdown passes and 13 TD runs. So he finishes up his junior year with 57 touchdowns produced. 57.
Incredible run.
Yeah.
And he's just a junior, right?
Just a junior. And by the way, his weapons like LeBron Bond, Javon Wiggins will come back from injury. You'll also have Matthew Williams and Elijah Moss. They'll be pretty stacked at wide receiver. And two of those backs are returning as well with Leon Fatman Clark and Damari Palmer. So this offensive backfield and the weaponry, the repertoire for Doreen McCain, it's going to stay in places. They'll be thinking about back-to-back next year in Class 5.
Awaiting the public address announcer's introductions here for the championship trophy and the state runner-up trophy. A valiant effort by the Stonebridge Bulldogs tonight. Fall short, 45-34.
A lot of celebrating will be going on back at home in Norfolk in the Tidewater area for this Commodores team.
All right, we'll join the PA announcer here for the post-game celebrations. Thank you.
Waiting the post-game trophy presentation now for Maury.
Avery, 23, Javonte Hughes, 24, Elijah King, 25, Amari Palmer. 26, Corey Jacobs. 27, Jaden Avery. 28, Tayshawn Branch. Number 30, Daquan Duke. 32, Stephen Taylor. 33, Tyler Privet Barnes. Number 40, Devon Powell. Number 41, John Morris. Number 49, Andrew McClung. Number 50, Les Matt. Number 51, Joshua Bowe. Number 52, Darius Bowman. 53, Corey Sandlin. 54, Shamir Flynn. 55, Javon Wynn. 56, Marquavion Morris. Number 57, Christian Murphy Riddick. Number 60, Jermaine Winder. Number 62, Zachary Wilson. Wilkerson. Number 63, Samuel Woods. Number 64, Maurice Perrin. Number 65, Mazier Tate. Number 66, Elijah Jones. Number 69, Marius Mitchell. Number 70, Larry Teasley. Number 71, Javion Thomas. Number 78, King Humphrey. Number 81, Charles McCoy. Number 82, Daniel Jones. Number 83, Liam Matthew Jameson. Number 85, Todd Easton. Number 99, Cameron Bennett. And number 99, Frank Field. We'd also like to congratulate the head coach, Tyree McCain, assistant coaches, Carlos Martinez, Mike Privet, Bryson Barker, Rodney Hughes, Demetrius Moon, Anthony Smith, Kevin Mills Jr., Ryan Black, Darius Blount, Drill Tevis, Daryl Jones, Mario Blair, Daquan Black, Wayne Davis, Warren Davis, Kevin Knight, Chris Evans, Orion Hall, and Vaughn Schofield.
So congratulations to the Maury Commodores, your 2023 VHSL Class 5 state champions. And they finish undefeated. 45-34 winners here tonight over Stonebridge. McCain getting the trophy, and we'll celebrate with his players. That'll wrap up our production here. We thank you for watching the NFHS Network. The 2023 football season comes to a close. I'd like to thank my partner Matt Hatfield, our producer Helene Shane, Jack Hayes up here helping us on graphics and on the broadcast, Ryan DeGerda, our top cameraman, and down on the field, Owen Hayes. We will see you all next year for some more exciting Virginia high school football. Congratulations to Maury.
He's gonna take it himself for a championship! A double play wins it for Frazier!
Turn it to the end zone. What a catch! McKay, it's on touchdown!
He's going to take it himself for a championship! A double play wins it for Frazier!
Turn it to the end zone. What a catch! McKay, it's on touchdown!